Jay Thomas Show. Sirius 108 and XM 139. This is the Jay Thomas Show. The interesting, the odd, and the bizarre people behind the, interesting. The odd and bizarre stories. Jay gets in, stirs it up, and spits it out. He's a professional. It's all here on the Jay Thomas Show with Rodney Lee Conover, Julie Madison, Kevin Meaney, Garrett and Christina, and Ira the Weatherman. This is the Jay Thomas Show.
All right. By the way, Ira is in the studio today.
Good afternoon, Jay.
Good afternoon, Ira. Ira the Weatherman, the most honest man we know, according to everybody at Sirius XM. We interviewed people. We talked to the lawyers. Garrett, he has been okayed by the legal department of Sirius XM.
By the head lawyer, actually.
The head lawyer?
Yeah.
They are so worried. You know, a lot of times, and it's happened, the dumbest one I've ever heard of a contest fix. It was in New York, Garrett, and you might have been working for Opie and Anthony when it happened. I don't know the state. I want to say KTU, but I'm not sure that it was KTU. But the promotions director had a friend of his win like an all-expense-paid trip to like the Bahamas or something, which is, you know, 2 hours from New York and maybe the whole trip. You know, remember, all these trips are traded out, so there's no real money, right? Mm. And he got caught and got fired, you know. I mean, I don't know what station it was. I don't know what it was. But you would always, you know, have to worry about someone in the building fixing a contest. And it would be like a secretary would get her friend to enter or whatever. And, you know, next thing you know, there's a. So they are so worried that we would fix a contest and break whatever law there is that you break in that arena. And so when we have a contest, that's why it has to be in the United States, because the laws in Canada are different. And once you cross international borders or whatever, and for some reason, Hawaii and Alaska are excluded a lot of times from these contests. I'm talking about the Holiday Road contest today that Ira the Weatherman will be drawing for a $500 winner. And so we have to okay the person. They don't allow me or Garrett or Christina or anybody. They did not find us to be trustworthy. Like, I may have a person's name in my, you know, up my sleeve. And when I reach into the hat, what does it look like? Is it actually a hat? What is it?
It's a container.
It's like a container.
It's the top to a stack of 100 CDs.
So it's what we said. It's a cyber hat.
Yes.
It's a internet hat.
It's very futuristic.
Very futuristic. Is it? And if our heads.
But your head wouldn't fit into it.
Well, yes, it would. If in the future our heads got smaller.
Because you need a skinny head. And people don't have skinny heads.
Well, not yet. Not yet, Ira. But they're saying that as we continue with this internet thing, of course, the internet's going to get, you know, even bigger. And long after we no longer walk on this planet, human beings' bodies will change. And the thinking will be done by machinery. And there are many evolutionary scientists who are saying that perhaps in the next, you know, 10,000 years, which isn't a long time when you think about it, the human head may get smaller because the brain, the thing doing the thinking is going to be a machine. Now that makes total sense. Why would you have to go to school and learn something if you can type a few letters into a machine and the answer comes up? What would be the use of school?
None.
None whatsoever. Why would you have to think? And so consequently, your head would get smaller. And I don't know if you know this or not, but the penis is supposed to get decidedly smaller in the next 10 or 15,000 years because you will have to stick it in those little holes in the computer.
But we'll be constantly thinking with our penis.
But Laverne likes big penises.
Now, Garrett brings up a point. If we're thinking with our penis, will our penis not get bigger? So I, you know what, Garrett? I'm going to call the people at Scientific American.
Yes, Science Wednesday. Can't wait.
Yeah, Science Wednesday. And I'm going to say, if the brain is going to get smaller, will the penis get bigger as we think with our penis? You know what would be so, I mean, we have no education to speak of. But when they do these reports at MIT or at Harvard or whatever, or Berkeley, it'd be so much fun to go, excuse me. Yes, in the back. Yeah. Oh, won't our penis get bigger? why would that happen? Because we'd be thinking with our penis. Have him removed. Have him removed. A friend of mine, my wife had a girlfriend visiting for the last, you know, 2 or 3 weeks, and like giggling children. Running around the house in their little pajamas and stuff every day. And the woman is a big yoga Buddhist kind of a woman. And so we're all sitting around talking. And you know that Uma Thurman, the famous actress, her dad is basically the Dalai Lama of the United States. Robert Thurman. They live in Woodstock, New York. And I've told you the story that when I had a home in Woodstock, a contractor guy that I had that built my home there, we go out to look at a lake, at a pond, some land around a lake, and we're looking at it, and I'm there with my girlfriend at the time, and we're looking, and all of a sudden we see a couple of naked girls and a couple of naked guys, and they're like, I don't know, maybe a few hundred yards away, and they're jumping in the water and giggling and laughing, and the contractor guy says, I mean, without, you know, batting an eye, that's my daughter, Greta, and her friend Uma. And I remember thinking, Greta and Uma, only in Woodstock, you know, and you know, no telling what the two, you know, the two guys' names had to be like, you know, Wyoming and Christmas or something, right? Stupid names. But that was Uma Thurman. So I saw her little bush when she was about 16 years old. And it was a substantial. Oh, absolutely. It was substantial. And the guys are all jumping and everything else in there. Now, me, after everybody left, my girlfriend and I got in, and my fear was that a snapping turtle was going to grab a hold of me. So I only would go in with my underwear on. She's in there flopping around with her, you know, boobs and everything. So this Uma Thurman, her dad was having a book signing, I think, in New York City at a Borders. And remember, he's a Buddhist, and the book signing is about love and peace and all of that. And people were asking questions of her dad. And some guy asked a few questions, and Thurman says, you know what? I don't like your attitude, and has the guy removed. And he's like a Buddhist. Right. So every time I hear Uma Thurman or whatever. Now, let's get back to what we were saying. Ira is the most honest person by far at SiriusXM.
I try to be honest, Jay.
Right.
I don't like to be corrupted.
No, you don't. Now, when you were a kid, I want to ask you, before we have this drawing, when you were a child, a lot of kids shoplift silly things, you know, gum,
yes,
pencils,
pins. Yes, they did shoplift. Some
you shoplifted.
Some of them get on, some of the people get on the buses without paying.
That's
no good.
I understand, but when
why should other people pay? Mm-hmm. And you know, we have to pay. And
if you would steal anything, if you would steal anything, I would hope it would be an antihistamine.
If I would steal something, Jay,
right.
They would put me in jail.
I know,
but
you
if
need...
another person, if a uh-huh. different race
right.
ever did it. Mm-hmm. They wouldn't be in jail.
Let's be very careful now, Ira, where we're going with this one.
All right.
It's like we have Ron Paul's son on the air with us today. What's that guy's name? The guy from Kentucky who said, you know, you ought to be able to discriminate by race at the workplace, okay? I don't know. I'm sure he's going to get elected in Kentucky, but
now,
hello.
I know you say Ira is uncorruptible. But you give the man a free hat and he votes for you.
Well, he's not corrupted by that. Your generosity is caused.
Like he's wearing an Assemblyman Michael Benedetto hat right now.
Yeah, but Benedetto, I bet you, is a liberal Democrat.
He's a regular Democrat.
Democrat.
He wants to be reelected to the assembly.
You need to start
very good.
I'm telling you this right now.
Claritin.
Every day you take one.
I did. Clarinex.
No. Every day you take one for the rest of your life.
I do.
You sure you do?
Yes.
All right.
He also has another life change that happened this week.
What happened, Ira?
That silence.
Do you not want to talk about it?
You didn't get anybody pregnant, did you?
Oh, yeah. I'm drinking something else, Jay.
What are you drinking?
I'm drinking seltzer from now on.
What did you used to drink?
Sodas.
Oh, because you want to lose a little weight.
Yes.
Oh, that's perfect. Okay. Now,
how much have you lost so far?
I lost around 2 pounds.
Oh, wow.
Not bad.
Not bad at all. What made you decide you needed to lose weight?
Well, I see a lot of obesity out there.
Obesity? Mm-hmm.
And this is no good.
Then when you looked in the mirror, did you feel as though you might be part of the problem?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, so cool.
I do the same thing. I do this. I look in the mirror and I go, you know what? If I'm going to talk about, you know, obesity and say that people shouldn't be overweight and everything else, then I have to live the life. And after a big meal over the weekend, right to the gym this morning, sweating, you know, elliptical.
Well, that's very, very good.
Oh, of course.
People
absolutely.
Should.
Right.
Go to gyms and other places. Take long walks.
Like you take long walks. That's right. Long walk. Now, let's get back to the contest. We had this contest, this Holiday Road thing, where people would recommend, and we even have one today, so we have to go to it first, Garrett, before we have the drawing, right?
Well, the guy that submitted it did not submit his phone number, and we've been emailing him trying to get it. So if he does not email his phone number in, he will not be allowed to be in the contest.
That's part of the rules.
Yes.
Oh, my God. Johnny Russell. Please, Johnny.
Call us. You can even call us and tell us it.
888-4102-102. Johnny Russell. And we won't say what state the place is in, because I figure you're from that state. Because you've stayed in this place, right? So, Johnny Russell, please call us and give us your phone number. And we know the state. By the way, beside having the drawing for the $500. Geraldo Rivera, is he stopping by or calling in? How are we going to?
He's calling us.
He's calling us. Now, I don't understand. I've known Geraldo, oh, God, my entire broadcast career, you know, 30-something years.
He's on Fox 5.
Ira, don't eat while we're on the air. Don't eat. Ira.
Kate.
Ira, don't eat. If you're going to come to work, this is not lunchtime, okay? You should have eaten already.
Okay.
I say this to everybody. Christina knows it. Garrett knows it. Everyone knows it. I don't like the eating.
All right.
What were you eating just now?
I was eating a pretzel.
Okay. Well, you put those outside the door, and you'll have a pretzel
later.
I'll
put it out the door. Yes.
And have a nice cup of seltzer water. Right. Geraldo has written another book, and he, of course, is Geraldo at Large, weekends at 10 o'clock on Fox News. It sounds like they've kind of shoved him late at night, right?
They shove him wherever they want to.
They shove him anywhere they want to shove him. All right. This book is an unusual choice. The Great Progression, How Hispanics Will Lead America to a New Era of Prosperity. Now, of course, he's half Jewish and half Italian. I mean, and half, is it Spanish or Cuban or? He's half Puerto Rican. Okay. Half Jewish, half Puerto Rican. There are a lot of people of that ilk in New York, by the way. And this is a hopeful book. And he will detail the myriad ways that Hispanics will help revitalize. How many is a myriad? When someone has a myriad of ways to do something? More than 1,000?
I think it's 45.4 million.
No, it isn't. I don't know what it is. Now, no phones are ringing. Is that because no one's calling, or is the phone's broken? Are the phones broken? Is. Are. The phone's broken?
I think they're leaving it open in case Johnny Russell calls in. They don't want him to lose his.
They're keeping him open?
Yeah.
Jay, I hope your weekend was a beautiful, beautiful one, Jay.
That's great.
You know, they predicted all kinds of weather over the weekend. They said, oh, we're going to get Hurricane Earl. Where right. the hell was Earl? He was down in in Long Island someplace.
Earl looked like he took a vacation,
he was
doesn't he?
Pissing yeah. out in Long Island.
Earl pissed out in Long Island. Now, you know what? If I heard that on Channel 5, I would go nuts if I was watching TV. I would think you're the greatest weatherman in
Thank
the history
you,
of time.
Jay?
Right.
Thank you. I am the greatest.
Mm-hmm.
What did I say to Garrett last Friday before mm-hmm. we left the studio? I said, what? It's going to be partly cloudy.
Oh, no. You beat mm-hmm. every weather person. You beat every weather person. So
you definitely didn't call me mm-hmm. from Atlantic City Thursday night saying,
no. mm-hmm.
I didn't.
Earl's coming. Mm-hmm. I might not make it to work because it's going to be
oh,
so bad.
Oh, yes. Earl was coming up the coast, but he's getting out to sea.
By the way, Garrett apparently had some sort of a emailing frenzy with this guy that said he quit listening, and we'll read that email, and then, of course, a complimentary email that we received. But the phones are lit up now at 888-4-102-102. After the holiday, we're all a little sleepy, aren't we? And the drawing will come in just a little while, and Ira, of course, it's a big Jewish holiday also, isn't
Jewish
it?
Jewish holiday coming up tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow night, it's Rosh Hashanah.
And what is that holiday about?
The Jewish New Year.
Why don't the Jews just have it the same time everybody else has?
No. We have ours separate.
I know you do. But that's another reason why people aren't that nuts about, you know what I'm saying. I mean, let's be honest.
Well,
if it was December 25th, and then January the 1st, and it was like, Happy New Year, and Jew and Christian hugged and everything else. But you don't do that. You have to have a time, some other time, and then you have to have a New Year, some other time. And it adds, it's like Ramadan comes in the middle of summer, you know, the Muslim thing.
Well, the Muslims.
You got to line up. You got to line up with the Christians. You got to line them up.
The Muslims have their ways. The Jews have our ways.
Mm-hmm.
And the Christians have
their way.
What year is it?
5771.
Wow, your head must be really small.
Wait a second. Wait a minute. It's 5771?
Yes.
What are you talking about?
That's what year it is.
No wonder Jews have so much small penises.
Well,
they're just shrinking at an alarming level. You know what? You don't see a Jew with a big head. You really don't. You don't see a Jew with a big head. So maybe their evolution has started, you know? I don't think it has anything to do with your culture. It has to do with the electronics. It's the electronics that are doing it. So let's go to Jim of Pennsylvania. Hello, Jim. It's Jay Thomas.
Good afternoon, Jim. It's around 86 degrees mm-hmm. out of Pennsylvania.
Right. Jim, Ira, the weatherman, is in our studios along with the lovely Christina Palumbo and Garrett Andritz. And I'm your main host, Jay Thomas. How are you, Jim?
Hey, everything is great. Thank you for asking.
Yes, sir. Go ahead, Jim.
I'm calling to tell you that a myriad is 10,000.
A myriad of things is 10,000?
Yeah, a myriad officially is 10,000.
So the term, when you say, you know, he came at me with a myriad of ideas, it's like thousands and thousands of ideas.
Or, you know, one just trying to express that it's a great number.
It's a great number. What language is myriad? That would be, is that Greek?
You know, I don't know, but I know in the scriptures it speaks of a myriad of angels collected together in heaven. So that would be mm-hmm. 10 million angels collected in one place. It's the largest number of angels spoken of in one group in the scriptures.
I love it when you go back to scripture. So you took 10,000 times 10,000, and that comes to, it has to be more than 10 million, right?
Yeah, maybe it's 100. I don't have a
100 million
in front of me.
Oh, I love it. I love that. Now, did you remember that from scripture, or did you find that on the on the equipment that we were just talking about that's going to make the head smaller?
No, I remember it from, you know, studying the Bible.
Wow. Jim, thank you so much. Jim of Pennsylvania. Thank
you. Take care, Jay.
Wow. Now, you see, Jim knew that, so his head is full of ideas. But soon, you won't need to have had read anything. You would just type in myriad, and all of it comes up. Scripture, the language, everything. And people say, well, wait a minute. What about when you're giving a speech? You'll need to know. No. Speeches will be a little slower. That's all. And the person will have the computer in front of them. And they'll just type. And if somebody says, that's not true, everybody pulls out their little tiny supersonic computer that, by the way, will be plugged in to their brain. That's the other thing. Remember that now.
Well, I want to say that's not true to Jim from Pennsylvania. A myriad,
what's that?
A myriad
what's
just
that?
Means a lot. It's a no specific number.
And a myriad of angels is what he said. And it was millions of angels. That's what he said. God, Garrett, I got to tell you, I don't think you're ready for the future, my friend. I really don't. So all of us will have a little chip in us. Never have to go to school. And we'll have all of this incredible knowledge. Some will be happier with mathematics, and some will be happier with liberal arts. Some will be happier with history or whatever. It doesn't mean that your personality won't enjoy one over another. But there won't, you know, Tulane University in New Orleans has been doing this a long time. They're the school, the medical school, that has put this thing in the brain that goes to the spine and allows people to move their legs who have been paralyzed. Do you know this?
No.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. They've doing it for... They tried to do it for Superman, but it didn't work.
Oh, I heard about that.
For Chris Reeves.
Yeah.
And then he gave a bunch of money to the thing, and it was out of Tulane University in New Orleans, and you see it all the time. And they've gotten better at it. But at first, the person would go, you know... Over here, Bill.
What?
Oh, over here. Oh. Because you'd have to think where you were going, right? Oh, you'd be all over the place. You'd go, Bill, not in there, Bill. Come back. Bill. You know. Then you'd line them up and they'd come back to you. It would have to, you have to get their brain, you know, lined up. Let's go. I can't wait for the future. Let's go to Carl of New Hampshire. Yes, Carl, it's Jay Thomas.
Hey, Carl, how are you?
It's not Carl.
It's
Carl.
Carl.
It's Carl.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
No, C-A-R-L, Carl.
Carl.
No. Say car. Car.
Car.
And then say L.
L.
That's his name.
Car-L.
Car-L, that's right.
Car-L.
God, it sounds kind of Muslim. When you say it that way. You know, if you were a football player, you'd have on the back of your jersey C-A-R and then dash E-L, Carl, you know? Like, what's that guy's name? Randall L. Hey, by the way, I want to say this to all of you out there in the last 20 years. Way to pick that number one religion. Nice going. I love the defensive back for Minnesota who's been fasting all summer long. He just, hey, nice religious choice. All right. Go ahead, Carl.
You know what I love about calling this show? Once you pick up, you know it's only another 10 minutes before you get to say something.
Hey, you know what? I don't believe it's the Carl from New Hampshire show, okay?
Yeah, okay.
You know, isn't it better that you hear somebody, I'm happy to be here, I'm excited, a lot's happened over the weekend, I want to share it with you, I want to give money, my friend Ira is there. Isn't it better than having somebody come on and, you know, I mean, what a downer friggin' Glenn Beck is all the time. Oh, it's all over, it's all bad. I mean, you know, what's the guy you work for, Christina, the left-wing guy? What's
Alex
his
Bennett.
Name? Oh, my God, it's all terrible, it's all bad, and all that shit. I come on and go, in the future, our heads are going to be smaller, our penises are going to be larger, and there are going to be chips in our head. Now, that is good news.
It is, and you come with a myriad of subjects, which just opens everything up. Hey, you were talking about that book, how that is going to lead America into the future.
That's our guest. Yes, that's Geraldo coming on. Yes, yeah.
Didn't they already make a movie about that? Machete? No.
By the way, is that movie any good, or is it just a movie that's it did well over the weekend, but they said mostly Spanish people went to it?
I've heard it's mostly beheading and breasts. I've heard that's what the whole movie is.
You know what? That's not a bad future either. When people have no heads but big tits.
Hey, you,
you don't get caught not looking
head
at their eyes.
Of course not.
Jews don't have big heads. How do you explain Larry King?
No, it's going to be in the future. It's not now yet. Look, this is in the future. It's going to happen. You're going to have a chip in your head. You won't have to think. Schools are going to be obsolete. I'm telling you. It'll be like everybody walking around is going to the University of Phoenix.
I can't wait till I don't need my head anymore.
That's right. All right, Carl. All right. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Your head will be the size of your thumb, and your penis will be this big bulbous thing. It'll look like a big nose. Rob of Oklahoma City. Yes, Rob, how are you?
I'm doing great, Jay.
How you doing, Rob? Rob in Oklahoma City. It's around 87 degrees.
Ira, give him the future weather, not the now weather.
Going to be 87 degrees for the rest of the week.
All right. Go ahead, Rob. How are you?
I'm great. I want you to know you are my official movie critic after Flame and Citroen and Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. I got to tell you, you're dead on with movies.
Well, here's the problem. These are incredible movies, but they're made in foreign countries. And in the United States, they're taking the movies.
They're going to ruin them.
They're going to absolutely ruin them. And I'll tell you another one you're going to love. You're going to love it. It's the vampire movie that's out right now called... is it I'm in Here, Garrett? Is that the new vampire movie? I'm in Here.
It doesn't ring a bell.
It's brand new. It's called I'm in Here.
Okay.
The Scandinavian version of it is unbelievable. It's fantastic.
Why won't Hollywood make movies that way? Because everybody I know that if I can convince them to read the subtitles, they're like, man, that movie was great. And
people don't like subtitles.
I'm not looking at Tom Hanks or Tom Cruise trying to picture them as a character. I'm seeing an actor that I don't know who the hell they are, and I just believe them as that character.
Exactly. And by the way, let me tell you something else. You should go out of your way to read the books that the girl that played with fire and the girl with the dragon tattoo. The books are so much, and they're deeper in that. The torture in the books is just unbelievable.
My wife and I read all three of them after I heard you on the show.
Wow.
I read it, and I said, you're going to love this. So she read it, and now we've seen two of the three movies at a local art theater, which is shocking they even have in Oklahoma City. But you can get some of these movies here locally. So I appreciate it, man. I just wish Hollywood would actually put out another than piece of shit movies, I guess.
Well, let me tell you what they've done now. I mean, they're trying everything. The WWE is now doing independent films. There are two out there. One is called Legendary, and the wrestler John Cena is in it. Yeah. I don't know what his name.
Cena.
Cena?
Yeah.
And then the other one is called Knucklehead. Who is in Knucklehead?
Knucklehead.
Right.
It doesn't say who is in it yet.
Okay. Knucklehead is got a really big guy in it. I forget his name, but
The
it's
Rock?
Got a, no, it's a guy with a name like that. Knucklehead. Now they got Patricia Clarkson in one. They are not about wrestling. They are puffy dramas. And they take these wrestler guys and they play these kind of, getting back to their daughters types of father.
Right.
It's Patricia Clarkson, Danny Glover, and John Cena.
Danny Glover?
And John Cena starring in Brother's Keeper.
And do you want to know who directed it?
Who?
Stephen Herrick from Mr. Holland's Opus. How the Mighty Have Fallen.
That's your claim to fame, is it not?
And I should be in these wrestling films, given, you know, this. In fact, Wendy Malick, who is a friend of mine I've known forever, who is on TV all the time and everything else, she's playing a nun in one of them. And I'm telling you now that when you're an actor and you're out there trying to get a job and they offer you a movie that a wrestler stars in and it's a drama, it's not about wrestling or shooting or whatever, you take it to make whatever fucking money you can get. And the whole time you're going, how these people have master's degrees from major universities and Broadway and, you know, everything. And they're with, you know, John Cena and the other guy in Knucklehead, you know. Oh, my God.
Hey, yeah. you mentioned another that I'm in here. The Scandinavian movie industry, is it, like, internationally known? I've never heard of any of them until I saw Girl with the Dragon Tattoo.
Do you know we're the only country in the world that does not subsidize the theater and movie industry? Every other country in the world subsidizes the theater and the movie industry. So when you see a movie where somebody is tied to a bed and they're getting raped by their father, the government gave them some money for that. In this country, holy shit, if you do something interesting and some right-wing religious asshole says, why would that artwork of Jesus made out of cow shit, why would that be subsidized by the United States government?
You're absolutely right, but why? I don't know, the whole thing.
That's as political as I'm going to get today.
Well,
I want more pictures of the saints in cow shit available to the children of America.
Daniel Craig is going to play the lead character in the American version of Girl with the Dragon Tattoo.
Right.
How much do you think they're going to tone that down? And that's another thing. The Scandinavian movie, the women and the men, they look normal. They look like real people. They don't look like, I mean, nobody walks around looking like Daniel Craig and...
Well, you know what? Now, I'm going to defend Daniel Craig. He is a terrific actor. There is a movie he made. Here's a movie you're going to love with Daniel Craig and Liev Schreiber. It's about this group of Jewish...
In the Resistance, in the Defiance.
Yes, Defiance.
That's a great movie. No, he's a great actor.
That is a great movie that didn't do any business and got bad reviews. But is an action movie about a group of individuals that really did something, and they shoot the shit out of the Germans, and it's all there. There's sex, there's guns, there's torture. There's why that wasn't a hit, I don't know. But the guys in the foreign movies, they're overweight. They have pock marks from acne and stuff, right? They have pock marks, and the women fuck them. And they
That's
have,
what I'm
and
saying. I
you know what?
Out of that movie, thinking I could actually get laid. And then
no, here's the, no, exactly. That's out. when you see somebody, you go, somebody says, "Oh, so and so, somebody, they're having an affair at work," and you go, "You're kidding? She's fucking him." That's what every right, Garrett. That's what everybody says.
Uh-huh.
She's fucking him.
Oh yeah.
I've actually heard people say that about me. I've actually heard.
You're fucking Jay?
I actually heard a guy once in college go, "She's fucking that clown," like that. Now, I happened to really be a clown in the circus at the time, so I took it as a compliment. But I don't know that he meant it. That's true. You're right.
Did you go to school at Jacksonville University?
Yes, I did. I am
the Dolphins, is that right?
I did. I'm a Dolphin.
I lived in Orange Park for a short time.
That's where I started my broadcast career. Orange Park, Florida. Right there, Big Ape.
Shit.
The Big Ape. Well, Rob of Oklahoma City, you've been on too long, even though we were having a lot. You and I should have a movie show on Spike.
Let's do it.
All right. We'll continue talking to you. Ira will pull a name for $500. Geraldo will be here, and it's all on this show. Actually, one of my favorite songs by The Circle, right, Garrett?
Wrong.
Who's it by?
It says Bobby V.
Oh, Bobby Vinton.
Bouncy, bouncy.
Bobby V. Bobby V. No, not Vinton. This B-E.
That's B-E-E, yeah.
Oh, he stole it from somebody. That's all. Let's go to Peter of Toronto. Hello, Peter. It's Jay Thomas. $500 winner coming up. We'll have a holiday road. Geraldo Rivera will be here, who's written a book about how the Hispanics will be leading us into the future. So I guess we'll look like one of those countries where they kill each other in the streets. I mean, come on. Is there a Hispanic country that you can look to that you would go, gee, I can't wait till we become Venezuela?
Spain?
I don't know.
Spain?
Ill-advised. Ill-advised. What? Spain?
Yeah.
I don't think they're talking about Spain.
Hey.
Yeah. Yes, Peter, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I'm on the edge of my seat, Jay.
We have the only listeners that when I'm talking about what I think is interesting, they go, hey, shut up! Go ahead, Peter. Yes.
Hey, Jay, I was sitting around on Saturday night with my wife, and I was having a few beers, and
sure.
I decided to Google some of your old Letterman appearances on YouTube, and it leads me to one. And they're good. They're funny as hell. But I got to ask myself, Jay, how does a guy like Ted Danson end up with a fucking career and you're on the radio? I mean, that guy's a fucking penis. Have you seen that show? He's got an HBO. He's horrible.
You know what? He's a very nice guy. He's been very kind to me. But, you know, there's a thing called a TV queue. Do you know what that is?
No. Oh, a queue is in, like, a queue rating?
Yeah. And so Ted also did a sitcom where he played this outspoken doctor for years.
It's fucking horrible.
It was awful. It was not funny. He's not a bad... He's a very nice guy. And, you know, it's a TV queue, and you can't fight it. I just mentioned Patricia Clarkson, who is a fabulous actress doing movies with wrestlers. And Wendy Clarkson, she's from Louisiana. She works all the time. She was in... Did you see the Leonardo DiCaprio movie? They're both the same movie. Shutter Island is the same as Inception, except Inception, they're all asleep. Okay.
DiCaprio's a fag. I don't watch that shit.
Well, anyway. Leonardo DiCaprio, Patricia Clarkson has a very big role in that. And now she's doing movies with wrestlers. You know, it's just difficult. It's just, there's no explanation for it. And you can blame it on agents but every one of my friends is switching agents and they don't know what to do and all. It's just the way it is. But the TV queue for Ted Danson is huge. When he's in a show, people go, oh, I'm going to watch that. So that's what
you must have a good Ted Danson story. You got any good Ted Danson stories from Cheers?
No, Ted's exactly what you see. Ted is like just a regular nice guy. No, he smoked. He liked to smoke dope. We all smoke. I mean, he married a much older woman. I don't know if you know that or not.
Yep, his current wife, right?
No. He's married to Mary Steenburgen. I did a show with him called Inc. where I played her boyfriend, and she was his ex-wife. And that only ran for like 10 episodes, but I was in that show with him. And, he had a much older wife who I think got really sick or something weird and had a terrible divorce and all of that stuff. But he's a very, very nice guy. Just a regular. And I'll tell you what he is. What you've got to see Ted Danson is in the movie, with William Hurt, and it's called Body Heat.
Oh, I've seen that. Yeah.
Okay.
Pretty good. You totally disappointed me, Jay. I was hoping you had some real douchebag stories on it.
No, hey. Nobody on that show was a douchebag. Nobody. Really? They really weren't. No, not at all. They all hated. She left the show. What's her? And I did a couple of movies with her and stuff. Come on,
Shelley Long.
Yeah, they all hated Shelley Long, but Shelley Long deserved to be hated. But the writers wrote that hatred into the show, which is hysterical. And so they wrote that, but she was quitting when I got there. But, even Rhea Perlman, people say, oh, she got you fired, whatever. You know, you meet somebody, you just don't like them. That's how she felt about me. Yeah. She just didn't like me.
Hey, Jay, what's the fucking problem with everybody in the studio? Well, not everybody, but you got so many people in the studio with like a saliva problem. Is that
You know what? We've hired. You know what? You're right, and I have one too. I have conquered mine, but you are correct.
You have, my friend.
I've worked my, and I'm not joking. I work my ass off, and there used to be a guy. I'm going to do. There was a hold on a second. One second. There was a guy in L.A. and he was on the air for just a short time, Garrett, but he came on against me, and he would go, oh, everybody's listening to Jay Thomas. Let me imitate him. He went like this. He used to put water in his mouth and do a whole bit, and he didn't beat me, but everybody would call.
He should only choke on it.
I know he should choke it. But he would call. People would call me up and go, whoever this guy was, hey, he's making fun of you, again. He got the water in his mouth. And when I'm doing voiceovers, because I'm doing a bunch for the Travel Channel, I am so nervous that they're going to hear me go, you know, like that. So you're right, though. And I think that I'm attracted to people who have the same affliction that I have.
With the same disability.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, if I was in a wheelchair, we'd all be in wheelchairs, you know. And here's what's funny. Christina was perfect when we hired her, and now she's totally mucusy.
She pops those fucking peas, Jay. You got to do something about
it. Yeah, pea popping mucus is what she is. All
pea
right.
Popping.
No, you hear that, Christina?
Jay. Jay, let me explain something.
Thanks, Peter. That's it for Peter.
Let me explain something.
Peter.
What
Everybody
is it?
Everybody has mucus. You see?
Mm-hmm.
That's logical. You have mucus also, Jay.
All right. I think we got that pretty much covered.
We got bad mucus. We have bad sinuses.
All of us do.
No good.
All of us have mucus. All of us have sinuses.
You know what? When I go home tonight, Jay,
yes?
I'm going to shoot my nose.
You're going to shoot your nose?
What I mean is I'm going to take a gun and shoot it.
Now, you know what? I don't even like to hear you joke like that.
Okay? Jay, well, right now... I'm sitting in the ha-ha chair.
Yes, you are. Okay.
I'm sitting in a chair that maybe Kevin Meaney or Mooney or
Meaney. Kevin Meaney.
Oh, Kevin Meaney. Yeah. Maybe he'll sit in the next chair.
We'll be doing some news, and we'll read your emails when we come back. Why would you play Shaft? Ira likes Shaft?
Yes.
I'm shocked. We got an email at Jay Thomas Show at SiriusXM, where, by the way, all of the Holiday Road entries came in, and we'll have a $500 winner in just a few minutes. Ira will draw that winner in just a little while. This guy, Scott McManigal, is that his name, Garrett?
That McManigal? Sounds like a name.
He quit listening to the show because I was making fun of deceased people and their loved ones. This was over the line. I can't imagine why anyone would stoop to such a level. I can't either, to be honest. But for some reason, I did it. I think you have serious mental issues. I hope that you never have a tragedy of losing someone and then turning on the radio only to hear some unfeeling creep making jokes about it. The one that really, I think, upset him was the golf girl who put the bag over her head and then the bag over her feet. And her friend, the doctor, who had prescribed pills to her, found her dead in the house. Okay. Here's how I feel about it. If you're driving to a funeral and you put on SiriusXM, the Jay Thomas Show, I feel sorry for you already. See? So I try and do it right during the funeral, if I can, so that the loved ones won't be listening. That's my answer.
It's kind.
It is kind. So you must have called this guy and said, would you like to come on the show and discuss it with Jay, right?
I emailed him the day you read the email saying, please call in. Yes.
Come in. Come on the show. Now, this happens all the time. People assume that I am going to you know, make fun of them or whatever. I just want dialogue. That's all I care about, okay? Just back and forth dialogue. I'm not trying to win.
Mm-mm.
I mean, you know that about me, don't you, Garrett? I'm not trying to win an argument.
No. You want to have a conversation with the guy.
That's it.
Yeah.
And if you win, fine. Because what difference does it make, Scott? You're meaningless and I'm meaningless. And zero times zero equals zero. Zero divided by zero equals zero. A myriad of zeros equals zero. And I don't say that to be unkind. We just heard from Peter in Toronto. I'm a zero, right? Wrestlers are making movies, okay?
Would you be in a wrestling movie?
In a minute, I'd play the nun in 2 seconds. Put a habit on me. You can kiss a nun, you just can't get in the habit. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. So now this guy writes you back. LOL, laugh out loud, of course. You want me to call in so Jay can cut me to ribbons on the air. Is that the extent of your offer? As attractive as that sounds, I'm going to decline. Although I'm sure I could keep up intellectually. I can only assume that I'd be walking into an ambush. What are you... You know what? If we had you call in, we would just hope that we could keep you on for 10 minutes to the next break, okay? I can't for the life of me understand why Jay would care what I think. Otherwise, I care what everybody thinks. Oh, this thing goes on. Garrett, I'm very disappointed because I always look forward to Jay's show on the way home. I love comedy, but my comedy tastes are very specific. You might even say snobbish. Who do you look? What are you, like Robot Chicken? Big snob. I find little talent in comedy performers. They're simple-minded, sophomoric. Thank you. Jay can make you laugh out loud, and then he starts with the dead people. He sounds like somebody's dad with all the things you could joke about. Why would you want to joke about dead people? I even caught him on PBS the other night talking about his narration of the old Ed Sullivan show. I chuckled to myself while thinking, if the big shots at PBS only knew some of the subject matter.
Well, this is Ed Sullivan. We have a big show for you tonight.
Now watch this. And, of course, Jay Thomas says, hold on a minute. Hello. He does what? He talks about dead people? You mean the golfer who put the bag on her head and the bag on her feet and took the pills and died? By the way, how did she do that? I mean, wouldn't you start losing your breath and want to rip the bag off? I mean, is that the phone call you wanted to make? Anyway, he wishes us all sorts of success, but he will never, ever listen to the show again or come on the show. Okay? Now, with the bad comes some good. Jay, Garrett, Christina, Shuley, and Ira, the Del Balzo family, had a fabulous time.
Yes, they went on a tour. I brought them to the next studio across the hall from us.
Yes. Unbelievable.
They all enjoyed it.
They got free soda.
They were walking down the street. They recommended something for Holiday Road. The next thing you know, the entire DeBalzo family, they said, we got to see the show in action, and we especially enjoyed seeing the servers. You mean the computers? Is that what they're talking
about?
Yeah. You took them into the server room?
I took them everywhere. They saw the entire building.
Did they see the satellite, the pictures of the satellite
yes.
and all that? Wow. Okay.
That's right.
There you go.
Did you
four
take
stars
them up,
here.
Did you yeah. take them up to the 37th floor?
No,
I
don't want
people would appreciate
that's
that.
That's just for you,
yeah,
Ira.
You can't,
yeah, we
you
don't want to go to the...
People up there.
You don't want to go up there and let the management know exactly what's going on down below, you know. The only time I see those guys is when I have my penis in my hand in the bathroom. That's enough for me.
Pull off the highway and into something amazing. Holiday Road. The J. Jay Thomas Show.
Well, somebody will win $500. Unfortunately, it won't be Johnny Russell because he didn't include his phone number and then didn't give us a call.
It's all time. He can get in.
Oh, he can? Okay. When are we going to have the drawing? How long before the drawing?
Well, I believe Ira has to leave in a half hour.
So we'll do it in the next 30 minutes.
Quarter to 10 to 5.
All right. Okay. Great, Ira. Thank you, Ira, for talking like that. Sounds like he's holding his breath. Like someone's strangling him all the time.
No, 10 to 5, G. Mm-hmm.
Go to adventuresuites.com. Let's welcome, it's spelled Brassil. Is it Brassil or is Brazil? How do you pronounce your last name?
Brassil.
Brassil.
Yes.
Out of all the guesses I made, I didn't guess Brassil. Brassil rhymes with brothel a little bit.
I never thought of it that way.
Really? Really? I did. I did. Now, Kathy Brassil, don't be nervous. You're on Holiday Road on the Jay Thomas Show at Sirius XM, being heard all over the world. Okay?
Excellent.
Your voice is going into outer space, ricocheting off of a satellite, being listened to by illegal aliens who are in outer space, by the way, not the ones that are on the
Earth. I'm in Mars right now.
That's one of our announcers
from Mars.
One of our announcers from Mars is coming in.
And then you're going to increase our illegal alien customer base. So this is great.
Yeah. The ones from outer space and ships at sea. And I went on vacation in the country of Belize. Was at a ecological little island. I mean, deserted. I go into a little bar at the end of a walkway, and I go, I'm the only person there, and sure enough, I hear the radio on. I said, what's that? Sirius XM. I'm telling you, it's unbelievable. So, now, what do you have there at Adventure Suites that's so exciting in North Conway, New Hampshire? What would cause us to go to the Adventure Suites?
Adventure Suites is a lot of fun. It's very unique. We have a theme hotel in North Conway. It's great for couples and for families. So you can actually spend the night in a cave. You can rent your own movie theater for the night with a 10-foot projection screen, a commercial popcorn machine, beautiful mountain views out in the back deck.
Wait. Slow down. Hold on. The cave I get, when you go into the cave, you've made it look like a cave, right?
Yes.
Is there like a fire in the middle? Or like, I mean, is the walls are made of rock-type material, right?
The walls are actually plaster.
Plaster walls. It looks like a cave. Okay, that I get. But the movie theater, you mean I would check into the hotel in North Conway, New Hampshire, and when I went in, would there be little seats and there'd be a big giant screen there?
Yeah, there's a 10-foot projection screen inside your hotel room. It has a projector, stadium-style seating, so the people sitting in the back are raised up a little bit. The bathroom is raised up even higher, so you can sit in your jacuzzi and see the screen. The speakers are right inside the bathroom.
Now, how many seats are in the audience?
It has a couch on the back row, and then two chairs. They're leather overstuffed chairs in the front row, so you can seat about five people right there. There's also a Mickey Mouse shaped wet bar that you can sit at. You can see the screen from there, and there's a king size bed. The room sleeps up to six people.
Now, you know good and well people bring in their dirty movies and show them on the big giant screen and then get in that hot tub, don't you?
I'm sure a lot of men would love to do that.
Boy, I'll tell you, you know what I think you ought to do? Put a camera in there so that you can have a video of the people, show it as they check out, and then charge them double, or you'll release the film. Huh?
Yeah, no, we don't do that.
You don't do that?
Like when you're on a roller coaster?
Yes, just like the roller coaster. Exactly. Now, where is the lovely town of North Conway, New Hampshire? When you're not in your room looking at these, you know, sexually instructional tapes, what do you do when you walk out of the cave or out of the projection room? Where do you go? What do you do around there?
We're in the White Mountain National Forest, which is where the Presidential Mountain Range is in the northern part of New Hampshire. There's a lot of great things to do, hiking, cycling, kayaking, horseback riding. We're right by Mount Washington, the tallest mountain in the Northeast that's claimed some of the worst weather in the world. You can drive your car right up to the top there. Mm-hmm. So we've got Conway Scenic Railroad. There's a lot of, or very, very popular tourist area. Storyland is really popular for the young families as well.
Did you say the worst weather?
Yes, the top of Mount Washington. They've claimed some of the most extreme winds in the world.
So you would go to a place and then drive to the top to see the worst weather in the world?
Yep. Yep.
Wow.
That's another adventure you can do.
That's unbelievable. Now, what is the Love Shack? I'm looking at your different rooms here. What's the Love Shack?
The Love Shack is our retro 70s funky room with a waterbed. It's got Cheech and Chong lights. It's one of our small, cozy rooms.
What is a Cheech and Chong light? What is that? What is a Cheech and Chong light?
It's there's lights that are above the jacuzzi, and they've got Cheech's face and Chong's face on them.
Wow. That may make it unable for me to have sex, to be honest. If I had to look
but
at
I bet
those
you've two. Never been in a hotel room with Cheech and Chong.
No, actually, I have.
Oh, yeah.
You know what? I have. That's the sick part. I've been in a condo. Does a condo count? A little condo?
Sure. I'll give you credit for that.
All right. And then you have one, it says here, the Treehouse. I mean, how big is this hotel you've got? I mean, it sounds like it would have to be like, you know, three city blocks to get these rooms in it.
Well, it's pretty big. It's 17 suites altogether. It's pretty good sized. For 17 room in, we're pretty good sized.
I'm coming on down.
Yeah. Now, Christina Palumbo, I just recommended a place for her in Woodstock, New York, and she went in at a wonderful time. How long would it take you by train, let's say, to get from New York City to North Conway, New Hampshire?
You would have to take the train to Portland, Maine, which would take you about five hours probably, and then you rent a car from Portland to here, take you about an hour.
So it's closer to Boston probably, right?
Yep, we're a 2.5-hour drive from Boston.
Christina, that sounds like, I mean, you'd go over there and you would, which room would you pick with you and this new boyfriend of yours?
I don't have a boyfriend.
Whatever.
I
want to
go in the Treehouse.
Yeah, now what's that about, the Treehouse?
And I have a car, so even better.
Oh, you drive there. Is there a tree in the room with you?
Yeah, there are different kinds of trees in that room. There's a big tree trunk they can crawl inside of that the kids can hang out. There's a picnic table in there, and they can stay right in there sleeping.
Well, you don't
there.
Have to. Not, she doesn't have any kids. Can she and the boyfriend get in the tree trunk?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I'm sure they can.
Mm.
You can hang out inside the tree house, inside the tree trunk, inside Mr. Squirrel's nut hut. Every room has a two-year larger.
It's not the only nut hut there'll be.
You would be in Mr. Squirrel's nut hut. That's where you would be.
Hey, that's where the PlayStation is, so it's a lot of fun.
Oh, Garrett should go then. There's a PlayStation. Yeah. Set him up.
And what does this cost? Generally, what does it cost, like, in the summer as opposed? Well, no, actually, it's after school. What can you get a room for now?
Our rates are essentially the same year-round, and they range, depending on the suite, from $109 to $479 a night.
$109 to $409. Now, what's a $109 room?
That's an economy suite, which has a queen-size bed, two-person jacuzzi, and a full-size bathroom that doesn't have all the extras, like the jungle room, which has the fiber-optic ceiling, so it's got starlit ceilings, a wet bar, a deck, a second-story glow-in-the-dark room, a five-person hot tub with rock walls around it.
My God! So in the jungle room, you turn the light on, the ceiling comes alive, the hot tub is going, and the bed has what, like a leopard, bedspread on it and all that?
It does, and it's round as well.
Good God Almighty.
The listener that suggested this place stayed in the jungle room.
He did? Johnny?
Yeah.
Johnny did? Wow.
I want to know has there ever been like a businessman that, you know, couldn't find a hotel room or a traveler and just had to stay in the Love Shack by himself because there was no other hotel available?
Well, we do have single people that come and stay with us, not because there's no other hotel room available, but just because of the jacuzzi, and we have over 1,400 complimentary movies to choose from, and it's just relaxing. We have women that come and just stay by themselves just to rejuvenate.
Wow.
I would check in and just, you'd never get me out of the Squirrel's Nut Hut, I can tell you that now. I would just get in there.
I think I'm going to check on him.
Yeah. What is the Dragon's Lair? What is that one?
Dragon's Lair is really popular. That's a combination of Gothic Asian furniture with a floating bed that's actually suspended from the ceiling.
Jesus, I love this place.
I changed my mind. That's where I want to go.
Yeah,
I love this place. So AdventureSuites.com, North Conway, New Hampshire, in the lovely White Mountains of New Hampshire. And now, do you get breakfast included?
Breakfast is included, where you can make your own waffles, toasted bagels, cereal, fruit, and yogurt. We also have a breakfast in bed service where we can bring it right to your room. We have a lot of great add-on packages where you can we set the whole room up for a birthday party, including a birthday cake and a wrapped present if you're celebrating a birthday. Your names embroidered on some robes that you can have set in your room. It's all right on our website. We have about 20 different options.
Well, it's fantastic. And how long have you had this Adventure Suites?
I've owned the hotel for 13 years.
Now, you know what? You sound like a wild one to me. Huh? I mean, if you thought of all of this, you're barking up my nut hut.
I think you have to be a little bit demented to come up with an idea like that. I agree.
I know. And Kathy, you thought of it on your own and opened it, and it was a what was it, like a Days Inn or something crazy before that?
It was a small motel, and we knocked down the walls and knocked up the ceilings, and we started small with theme rooms, nothing too major, but we just got a great reception from people. So each room outdoes the room before it, and we're still remodeling rooms. Our smaller rooms we're going to make bigger.
Kathy, say your last name again.
Brassel.
Kathy Brassel.
What's
AdventureSuites.com.
What's the next room you're working on?
We're going to do Wonderland, which is a two-story suite with two bathrooms. It's going to be a cross between Cheech and Chong and Alice in Wonderland, and with a B-52s bar, dance floor, tin roof.
You love the Cheech and Chong thing, don't you? You love that Cheech and Chong thing.
I can't sing Sleigh Bells Ring. Are you listening?
Yeah. That makes me think, Kathy, that you might be voting for the medical marijuana initiative there in New Hampshire.
I think everybody should just have a good time, especially when they're at Adventure Suites.
Have you had any gay weddings there? Because that's legal in New Hampshire, isn't it?
Yeah, we've advertised for them. We do weddings. We do what we call micro weddings, which are really inexpensive weddings here. But we haven't had a same-sex marriage here yet.
Well,
we'd be more than happy to perform.
Can I be blunt for just a moment?
You haven't been yet.
You need the dildo room. That's what you need. The dildo room. Let's be honest. I have plenty of gay friends, male and female.
You don't even need a gay, just yes. In general.
Well, no, that's too nasty. When you think of people of the same sex getting married, they don't need equipment. But people of the opposite sex don't need equipment. People of the same sex, they need special equipment. Now, look at this. You put the nut hut in there, okay, and the giant squirrel thing. You know, like the whack-a-mole?
What?
You sit on that thing. It's like a whack-a-mole. Jesus. I'm telling you. You would
not
have
familiar
the
with that.
Same, the whack-a-mole, where the little animals
like
come
a
out
carnival
of the...
game.
At a carnival, they come out of the thing
with
a paddle. You'd have, except it would be sex-a-mole. You'd sit on top of it and blah, 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 like that.
Whack on penises instead of moles.
You whack on a penis. Thank you. Now you know what? Now we're thinking alike. And you know what? You do not let straight people go in that room.
Not allowed.
It's only for same-sex couples. It would light the White Mountains on fire, okay?
I can see how the lesbians might want to do that, but not quite sure how the gay men would want to be whacked.
Are you kidding? You couldn't. By the way, once you put whack-a-penis in a room, they won't. There's no kayaking, okay? There's no kayaking. They would be in there for weeks. All right.
Yeah, you know what? Get into a family room. The kids can have the fun too.
Sure. Well, what you'd have to do is you'd have to take away the lubricant. Okay. Only when the same sex couple comes in, you don't have the lubricant. Well, Kathy, wonderful.
You sit on the table and wait for the penis to jump up. Is that where the lubricant comes in?
You know, Kathy, you're actually taking my idea and running with it. That's what you're doing.
That's what I do.
Okay. Kathy Brassel.
I wish
I mean this. I wish I was close enough to go there. I would, and because I'm married, but I have a gay lover, I would take my lover, and he and I would be in the nut hut for months.
Where are you?
I'm in Santa Barbara, California.
Oh, yeah, you're far away.
A long way away. There is something like this halfway between here and San Francisco.
The Madonna Inn?
Yes, that's right. You must know all of these places, right?
Well, I heard about it. You know, when I started this hotel, I wasn't aware of any other theme hotels. Completely ignorant of it. But people had mentioned the Madonna Inn. I actually stopped in there one day.
It's okay.
They're different than us in that they don't have the jacuzzis in the rooms, and their themes are different. It's a nice theme hotel.
You got to have the jacuzzi, because when you go in these rooms, okay, you're looking around, it looks like a castle or whatever, and then, you know, you go outside. You get the jacuzzi going. I love the one with the movie screen. Now, do you have a bunch of movies available to people?
Over 1,400 complimentary movies, DVDs to choose from.
Has anybody ever gone in there and watched Mr. Holland's Opus?
I don't know. I don't think we have that in our collection.
Well, you got to get it. You got to get that one. You got to get
that. It is a great movie.
Wait a minute. How about My Date with the President's Daughter? Do you have that one?
No. Should I be writing these down?
Yes. Mr. Holland's Opus, My Date with the President's Daughter, Chud.
What do all these movies have in common?
Well, wait a minute. Chud. Hold on a minute. Hold it. Dragonfly. Hold on. What other piece of crap have I been in?
Man Push Cart.
No, I'm not in Man Push Cart.
I got that from the library today.
Well, I'm sure you did.
City Ember.
I'm not in City Ember.
All right. Journey to the Center of the Earth.
Wait, I'm not in that one. We don't want that one.
And Nothing Big by David Schwimmer.
Killing Mr. Griffin is one you'll love. Killing Mr. Griffin. I got a bunch of.
Not
all right.
Criminals.
Kathy Brasil, thank you. The Adventure Suite sounds fantastic. What a way to end the summer with an exciting Adventure Suite idea. You go, there's a jungle room, there's a Woody Allen, no, not Woody Allen, the Cheech and Chong room.
You know. The Harley Davidson room, you can drive your motorcycle right into the room.
No, you can't.
Awesome. An attached motorcycle garage right in your room.
Wait a minute. If you're on a motorcycle, you can ride the motorcycle into the room.
Automatic garage door opener right on your keychain, yeah?
I'm telling you now, go to AdventureSuites.com. This is the best theme hotel idea I have ever heard.
What's the thunder box in the jungle room?
All right, that'll be enough of that kind of talk.
Oh, that's an Australian term for thunderbox. Have you heard of that before? That's where the toilet is.
I think we should take a road trip here.
This is unbelievable.
Definitely.
All right. Hey, Kathy, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Okay, thank you. Great.
Have a nice evening, all right. Kathy.
Adventure Suites. Wow. That's unbelievable.
Holiday Road for your summer. From Jay Thomas. Stars 2.
Man, that's unreal. We'll have a drawing for $500 in a few moments. Tom of South Carolina. How are you, Tom? Now, I got to tell you, if you were close to New Hampshire, wouldn't you jump in your car and go to that Adventure Suites place?
I'd probably jump on my moped. I could go in the Harley room. I'd just drive my moped in that.
Yeah. Drive your moped into the Harley room. That's right. That's right. And then get off your moped and jump on Whack-A-Dick.
That's right.
With your little helmet on. You have your little moped helmet on and your checkered shorts, and you jump right on it.
Yeah. You don't need a moped. You don't need a helmet in South Carolina. We live dangerously.
Look, I have to tell you, I know mopeds are great, and I know that they get, you know, 80 miles to the gallon. I cannot, the embarrassment of putting around in one of those things, no good. No good.
I got a theme room, Jay. I mean, now they have a reality TV room where as soon as you walk in, you're on TV in your room. And you're on TV from the time you get there, and it's on like 12 or 15 screens.
Garrett, call the lady back. Call her back. Call her back. This is, you know what? We never did this before because it always turned out badly. But the last couple of times we've called the guest back, it's turned out fabulously. Mm. Call her back. We have an incredible idea. The reality TV room.
That's right. And you have all of these.
I love this idea. You go in the room and you are on TV the whole. Now, Christina, do you like, you gotta love this one, Christina.
I love this idea.
And when you leave, you take with you the only CD, the DVD of your own reality weekend, right?
Or on the other hand, you could post it on the internet if you wanted to, and they could, you know, rent it out if you wanted to. You could post
this guy called it. We got to get her back. Get Kathy back.
She's
on.
Back. She's on.
Kathy, it's Jay Thomas. How are you? Kathy, Tom of South Carolina has an unbelievable idea, and I mean this. Tom, this is Kathy from Adventure Suites in was it North Conway, New Hampshire? Is that it?
That's correct. Hi, Tom.
That's right. Tom, go ahead. What's your idea?
The reality TV room. So as soon as your client, your customer walks into the room, all of the cameras be focused on all different sections of the room. You have TVs throughout the room, and you are on reality TV in your own room throughout your visit. And of course, you can post it on the web, or you know, make a CD and take it home with you after you leave.
A DVD at the end of the weekend, you get this that nobody else has, this DVD, but you have been reality, you know, videoed all weekend long. What do you think of that, Kathy?
Yeah, we could streamline it on the web constantly.
No. The person wouldn't want that, probably. You'd want that? You know what?
Absolutely.
But they want some hotel worker hey. To view hours and hours of their weekend and edit it down into a show?
No. They have their own DVD. When they go home, they go, this is our own reality show. And you'd have like the pictures
like
of
home movies,
John and Kate.
48 hour long movie,
whatever it is.
Garrett, this is a great idea. I don't know why you're putting it
this
down.
This is us sleeping for 8 hours.
You know what, Kat? I'm not, you know what,
see, that's the difference of your vacation versus mine.
I would come alone and I would just sit in a chair and then I would play Whack-a-Dildo for a while. Then I'd go into the Chuckle Hut, whatever that is you got in there. Go in the Chuckle Hut.
Do you know that you're being recorded, or do we tell you this at Chuckle Hut?
No, you have to know. No. It is decorated in with reality TV stars, and you can flip a switch, and the reality camera comes on, and at the end, only you get the DVD, and only you can see what's going on.
You call it the Truman Room.
Wow.
Oh, no.
I think this is going horribly wrong, Jay.
Yeah, Tom.
Tom, you're letting everybody take control of your idea.
It's the reality. This is what it's like sitting in one of these stupid meetings with these idiots that I have to go, oh, okay, I guess that's a decent idea. It's called the reality, right, Tom? The reality TV suite.
It's a reality TV suite.
Is there a camera in the Thunderbox?
There can be. There can be. But you know what's in the you know what? That camera has no sound. So you see the act, but you don't hear it.
And there's night vision.
That's more lightning box then.
No night vision.
It's got to be cameras everywhere. I mean, there's got to be like, you know, 20 different cameras with...
You know what, Tom? Tom, stop it. There's going to be like 3 cameras, okay? 20 different cameras. What do you think she's made of? Money, for God's sakes?
It could be one of your higher priced rooms. You know, that would be the $408 suite.
It's the editor who gave him 20 different DVDs.
That's right. Well, thank you, Tom of South Carolina. And Kathy, I'm glad we gave you a new idea, okay?
Thank you so much.
My pleasure. My pleasure. Wow, it's unbelievable. You know what? You start these shows, and you don't know where they're going to go. I really don't. I don't know. And you know, this guy that sent this letter doesn't listen anymore because I made fun of dead people, okay? I want you to know something. This show is not about me. No. Who is this show about, Garrett? Who's this show for?
Ira.
The people.
No. Thank you, Ira. It's the people. And when I say the people, it's you. In fact, when I spell the word
if
job...
If it wasn't for the people, Jay,
yes?
Where would our show be?
Nowhere!
Out the window.
It would be in the Thunderbox. I spell the word... Garrett, how do I spell the word job? How do I spell it?
J-O-B.
No! That's too obvious. How do I spell the word job, Christina?
J-O-B.
No. It's too easy. Garrett,
well, we know thanks to Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, J was an H back in the day, so it's H-O-B.
No, I spelled the word job Y-O-U.
My next guess was F-U-N.
My job is you. That's it. That's how I think. I walk in the room. It's not M-E. No, I don't spell it M-E or M-E-E. That would be three letters. It's Y-O-U. That's right.
Y-O-U.
That's all I'm thinking about.
A-E-Y-O-U.
There you go.
U-U.
How would you like to be stuck for 48 hours fasting with Ira over this Rosh Hashanah holiday?
No, you By the don't way- fast on Rosh Hashanah next Friday. Next Friday night. Not this Friday night, but next Friday night is Yom Kippur.
It you mean begins, another friggin' holiday next week?
It begins at 7 o'clock next Friday night.
For Christ's sakes, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say for Christ's sakes.
Jay,
it's September, for goodness sakes.
Well, the holidays come out real, real early.
Have them when the rest of the world has a holiday.
We don't.
All right. Coming up, Ira the Weatherman, the
Jay,
most honest.
In yes, fact... What? If you want to fly on in, you can come to our services tomorrow night, Thursday, Friday.
Next week, I'm in town next Thursday and Friday, but I'm not going
All
to any
right.
services.
You're
very busy.
You're going to come to my shul next Friday night.
You know, I did have one of my wives was very Jewish.
Shalom to her. Shalom, shalom.
Well, she's gone now, not the one I have now. And we would try to go to the temple, and she'd have to buy like a ticket or something. And for like, we weren't married a long time, but for the 2 years we were together, she couldn't get a ticket. And I would say, wait a minute, we want to go worship for this Jewish holiday, but we can't get a ticket? She goes, no, it's sold out. So we couldn't go. You know, we lived in, you know, I think Charlotte, North Carolina at the time.
There were no scalpers? I think
no,
there are scalpers.
You mean like at a Kiss concert?
You go out and play? Yeah. Hey. You see, Garrett, they don't call it scalpers. We don't have any scalpers. Uh-huh.
What do they call it? Really?
If they're sold out, they're sold out. So you go to the next temple.
You carry a sign, Garrett, that says in Hebrew, got two? Need two?
No.
Need a pair, but it's in Hebrew. All right. The old jail museum we visited in Jim Thorpe, Pennsylvania. The Wisconsin Cow Chip Throwing Festival in Sauk City, Wisconsin. Matt Barker brought us the old jail museum. Kevin Brushhaber brought us the cow chip. The old Rhinebeck Aerodrome. Oh, my God, that was a bad one. But Mr. Del Balzo, he did that one. Potato Days in Barnesville, Minnesota by Joshua Hagenson. The World Erotic Art Museum in Miami, Florida. That was a good one. Mickey Mathis. The El Dorado Canyon Mine Tours. Now, that person got angry at us, didn't they?
They sent an email. Well, the wife of the guy sent an email.
What was her problem?
That we only focused on the cock and ball rock.
Well.
And the cave being a vagina.
Ken Pearson sent that one in, even though the focus of that fabulous holiday road was unhappy with it. Lila's Hair Museum. Remember Lydia Mackey of Lila's Hair Museum? Jen Metzler and Jeff Ray. You know what? It is hard to bring back the memories of so many incredible places.
That was a place where you would have... have like a baby doll, and then you'd put your baby's hair on the doll and save it as a memento.
And she had, I believe she had the Virgin Mother's hair, didn't she?
Yes, she did, yes.
Didn't want to break it to her.
It was provable, apparently.
Really? Mm-hmm. World's Largest Ball of Paint in Alexandria, Indiana by Marcus Myers. That was where the guy painted a golf ball, I believe.
I think it was a baseball.
40 years later, it's this giant.
He had to build his own shed out back to house
it. They have this big, and you can go there and paint the ball.
Jay, this is from CNN. Is fear of Islam.
Boy, it went away.
And let me
tell you. The Chiron went away.
Korans. It's unbelievable. This nation is unrealistic. I hope nothing happens to it. I really mean this.
You know, Ira, thank you very much. I'm in the middle of, telling the people who may be winning $500. That's okay. But I appreciate how you're interested in our nation. Do any Muslims go to the Rosh Hashanah celebration or the Yom Kippur?
No, they don't. Okay. No Muslims.
Just checking. Largest twine ball made by one man in Darwin, Minnesota. Tom DeCosta sent that in. The Cockroach Hall of Fame in Plano, Texas. That was sent in by three different people. Chuck Shipman, Casey Harrison, and Chris McCoy. But only one can win, right, Garrett?
Only one, yep.
Only one. The San Antonio Toilet Seat Museum. Now, over the weekend, didn't we run a special?
What, they wanted to do a show from a toilet?
Good one, Ira.
Thank you, Ira. Didn't we run a special over the weekend of all the holiday roads?
Yes. Well, not all of them.
But a lot of them.
We only had 2 hours that we were.
Chuck Shipman. Harvey Fights Opus 40 that Christina went to. Thad Rutherford sent that one where the guy had built this, just taken the rocks from his land, and then finally the tractor flipped over and killed him. His son runs the place, his stepson. What was the stepson's art like, Christina? You remember the guy?
It was.
Would you have bought any? No.
It wasn't my style.
Wasn't your style.
He's talented, but not my style.
Well, what kind of style was it?
It was like a little. I'm not.
Remember now, theater of the mind.
Right.
This is how I'm training you.
It was. Watercolor looking.
I know, but of what? Was it trees? Was it people?
Trees and people.
Rocks.
Hold on. Trees and people.
Christina.
Yes.
I want you to look up, and then you come back. There is impressionistic art. Okay. Impressionistic.
Right.
Cubist art. Okay. Modern art. Okay. Look up the types of art. Look at the pictures of the art. And in a few minutes, I'm going to ask you which discipline he fit into. All right?
Okay.
That's how I'm going to do it. So please look that up and let me know in a few minutes.
You got it.
Thank you. And by the way, when I'm whispering for effect, don't whisper back.
Okay.
The Cockroach Hall of Fame, San Antonio Toilet Seat Museum. And he, what, Garrett, he had the toilet seats that had the American flag on them and...
The Jay Thomas Show on one?
No, that's right.
Yes.
Chuck Shipman, Opus 40. The National Bottle Museum in Ballston Spa, New York. That did not turn out well. That woman, that old bottle bitch, she didn't like me. What could she not like me for? What the hell could I have done to her?
It was your constant questions about the outhouse and digging in the outhouse.
Well, that's where you find the bottles. My wife collects sea glass.
Really?
I got to put my paper down. It's so embarrassing when I tell the things that I live with. She goes to the beach and she finds sea glass, which is worn down of its sharp edges because of the turbulence of the ocean. And the sand and the salt. She found a bottle. I'm going to bring the bottle in. I mean, but it's like an old bottle, and on the outside of it, it's embossed and it says liver, like a liver tonic or something. Nice. You know, that people would drink it. I'm looking at that bottle, thinking, oh my God, I should ask the woman from the National Bottle Museum. And I stopped in the middle of my thought. I wouldn't call. I'll tell you what. If she was the last bottle museum on earth, I wouldn't call her.
I thought about removing Jim and Scott
No.
The contest.
No, no. You can't blame Jim Botta and Scott Hyland. You can't blame them.
Okay, I thought
they
about
didn't
it.
Know. The UCM Museum in Abita Springs, I went there personally. Now, what does UCM stand for?
I completely forget.
I did too. I went there personally. I still don't remember. that was brought to us by Bill Dillon and Bernie Marino. The Beer Can House in Houston, Lisa from Louisiana. The Muter Museum, that was the medical museum in Philadelphia. Catherine Johns, Martin White. The M. Schechtel Freight Sales. What's that? In Oshkosh, Wisconsin.
That was the place that had really huge display items that I guess stores used to use or whatever, and they keep them there, and you could buy them.
The Bunny Museum. Pasadena, California.
Remember how hoppy the guest was?
That's right.
Yes.
The Hat Creek Radio Observatory in Hat Creek, California, where this poor bastard's trying to... Once they hear the aliens speak. He's a PhD. Have you ever heard anything? No. I asked him if they had a little barbecue pit outside of the boring fucking office he lived in. Historic Auto Attractions in Roscoe, Illinois. Dennis Wolf.
That was
world's
the best
large...
one, I think.
No, it wasn't.
Remember the guy had, like, Hitler's car and...
Oh, that's right.
Heroes...
Oh, that's right.
Outfits and Kennedy's flag and his casket.
Right. He had Jackie Onassis's. He had one of her tampon strings. an amazing place. The world's largest hand-dug well in Greensburg, Kansas. Eldon Buell sent that in. Now, why were they digging that well? What was that all about? Why would they dig that?
I think for water.
No, but I mean, couldn't you help dig it? You could go and keep digging.
Yeah.
Just keep digging the well. The Texas Prison Museum in Huntsville, Texas. Rick Bishop, they had the electric chair there. Old Sparky. Testy Festy. Oh, the Testicle Festival. Clinton, Montana. Dan Devereaux. The Dildo Museum in San Francisco, California. Martin White sent it in. Now, that woman was fun.
Yes.
Who had the dildos. And she invited me to their next outing, or inning, whatever they call it.
In and outing.
De Youper's Tourist Trap in Ishpeming, Minnesota.
Michigan.
Oh, Michigan. Alan Couture sent that in. What was the tourist? It just you saw stupid stuff there?
Yeah, and they had, like, the world's largest working chainsaw out front. And
no, that's right, the big chainsaw.
It was like south of the border, but for the north.
The future birthplace of Captain Kirk, Riverside, Iowa. Dean Latta sent that in. Jules Undersea Lodge. She was, you know, the woman was great. Now, Carol DeJuba sent it in, right?
Yes.
She was so nervous that she could not go on the air with us.
Correct.
You said that she became flush or stammering or something, right?
That's correct.
Poor woman. The Adventure Suites Hotel.
Not an extra.
Can't use it. Sorry, you didn't send in your phone. The Porter Thermometer Museum in Onset, Massachusetts, Spencer Osborne. So those are our finalists. Yeah. They all got on the air. And by the way, we want to thank each and every person sent in an entry, no matter how stupid or shitty the entry was.
I believe we had over 140 entries and 35 good ones.
You don't hear someone say, thanks for your entry, even though it was really stupid and uninteresting and no one would ever want to stop at this place. But thank you anyway for being stupid and uninteresting. And when we come back, somebody wins $500. Wow. Never a dull moment on the Jay Thomas Show at Sirius XM. And Ira the Weatherman is here. And he'll be leaving to start his Rosh Hashanah celebration after he draws... for the $500 winner. I just laid out who they were. And it was, I mean, I'm not kidding. Christina made mention that it was nostalgic. Now, these are just the ones we've done in the last few months. Imagine the other, I don't know what, myriad, certainly, Garrett, myriad, as was mentioned in the Bible, of holiday roads we've done. I mean, even PBS, you know, National Public Radio, they've stolen this idea from us. Many of these channels want to do something. I haven't chosen the right channel yet for my holiday road television show, but I will. Drum roll, whatever you want to do. Let's draw for $500. This is always difficult because many of you that are listening right now, you have no interest in these people who are about to win $500. You did nothing. You didn't mail anything in. You didn't try. Your name didn't make it, whatever. So it's hard for me to just pick out these. How many people? 30 people? 35 people. Yeah. 35 people. And then one of them will win. If I were you and I were listening to the radio and I heard a person's name pulled and they won $500, I couldn't yell at the radio loud or long enough. I would say nothing but derisive things. Okay? That's what I'm like when somebody wins and I'm not a part of it. When I watch a quiz show, I'm pulling for them to lose. Okay? So, whatever emotion you want to have, negative or positive, you may have it. Okay? Here we go, Ira. Let's pull it. Here we go. Let's draw. $500. We have nothing more modern than that. Well, at least that moved us into the 19th century. Thank you, Garrett. World War One. Thank you, Garrett. We're all the way up to 1917. Thank you so much. There you go. 1953. Now, go ahead, Ira. Pull the name.
Liz Mary.
Oh, get the hell out of here.
Liz Mary.
You can't pull her name. She listens all the...
Pick another one?
No.
No, you can't. That's impossible.
That's amazing.
She is a constant listener to this show.
Well, it pays off, Liz Mary deserves it.
I'm not sure if she deserves it.
Oh, yes. We gave it... I picked it out.
Yes, you did.
From the hat, and I did it marvelously, Jim.
Yes, you did.
Marvelous.
What did Liz Mary send us? I didn't even mention her name in the lineup when I saw it. I went, let's just go by her. Hat Creek Radio Observatory. Liz Mary wins $500. Garrett, you going to get her on the phone?
Yeah, I'm calling her right now.
Sure, give her a call. Let's go to Mark of Ontario while we're waiting for Garrett to get our $500 winner, Liz Mary. Yes, Mark of Ontario, how are you?
Not too bad, yourself?
Oh, good. You know, got a job, you know. My wife's not fucking anybody, so life's good, you know?
Well, yeah, no kidding. I'm in the same boat, so that makes me pretty
Yeah,
good.
You got a job, you haven't caught your wife banging somebody else. My kids aren't on drugs yet, you know, so everything's okay. You meet people, you go, hey, what's going on? Oh, I lost my job. My wife's leaving me. My kids are no goddamn good. Like that. I go, oh, well, I'm better off than you are. So there you go, Mark. Go ahead, sir.
Well, I just wanted to say I'm a first-time listener, and I'm really getting some laughs out of your show, and I'm at work right now, and I'm listening to you, and then a loader there. I'm working at a gold mine.
Wait a minute. You work at a gold mine?
Yeah, I work at a mill. We crush all the rock and take out the gold from that, and then pour it into bars.
How do you not?
Working on the gold mine.
Now coal mine, not gold mine.
Coal mine.
No, gold mine. Now wait a minute. How do you not stick your hand in the dirt and just put some in your pocket? I don't get it.
Yeah, well, you know, it's to find somewhere to take that gold out, and it, you know, you're full of dirt anyway all day. It's not like you want to bring this dirt home anyway.
No, but there could be gold in it.
There could be, but we're just processing muck that has 2-3 grams per ton, so it's really, you know, you'd have to bring lots of tonnage at home, and you know, everybody would notice it. So,
2 or 3 grams a ton to get a little tiny, 2 or 3 little tiny grams of gold. Now, 100 years ago or 200 years ago, was there gold everywhere, and you guys have just sucked it all out of the mountain?
Yeah, that's probably what happened.
Wow.
Now there's just small amounts left, and they're still making money taking it out. So,
and what do you actually run a piece of equipment? What do you do?
Right now, I'm in a loader, a 980 CAT loader, and I go into the muck pile and pick up a full bucket and drop it in the apron feeder, and off it goes into the crushing plant.
Did you hear all of that? He goes into the muck pile, then puts it into the apron feeder. Jesus Christ!
Yeah, I pick up about 14 tons of raw material and send it into the crushing plant, where then it gets crushed.
Do you have any gold on your body right now? You have a gold ring, a gold watch, a gold necklace, anything?
Yeah, well, I have my wedding ring, and that's made out of white gold. So
white gold. All right. So you may have milled the gold that you are wearing on your finger.
Possibly.
Have you had any deaths there? Anybody ever die at the gold mine?
Not since I've been here, no, but I've heard one guy got his arm caught in one of the pulleys, like one of the conveyor belts. He was just trying to clean the end pulley, and his arm got caught in there, ripped it right off.
Good Lord.
Oh, yeah. And like,
did they gold plate his arm? Did they give it back to him, but in a box that was gold plated?
That arm just went through a massive roller and just got squished, so there was no arm left whatsoever.
So you mean the arm might have ended up being crushed up and become a part of that 2 or 3 grams of gold dust that comes out of the ton?
Yeah, possibly. I'm sure it was a big mess. So,
you know, my wife has a diamond ring that looks very much like a knuckle.
Yeah.
It's kind of a knuckle shape to it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, we also, like, we produce about maybe 2 bars of gold a week, which isn't very much for in the area I'm in, but that's roughly 2.5 million in a week, so it's not too bad.
Two little bars of gold. What's a bar weigh?
1,000 ounces, so it's heavy enough. Like, to just grab it off the table there, you can't, like, unless you have freakishly strong hands there.
Well, wonderful. You know what? You called to tell us how you enjoy the show, and then you introduced us to an amazing business, and there are people now have information about gold mining that they'll never forget. So, Mark of Ontario, thanks for listening. I hope you continue enjoying the show and keep mining the gold. Now, do you have blood gold? You have the blood gold where you finance the killer?
Maybe in higher up management, but
yeah.
That's the bell, no.
Yeah, no, you don't have blood gold where you are. Okay, thank you. Mark of Ontario, thank you. Because I only wear blood diamonds. The only ones I wear.
All right. Well, thanks for having me.
All right, stay where you are. My pleasure. We'll have a person whose salary or whose finances we probably doubled when we come back. We'll be talking to Geraldo Rivera from Fox. He has a new book about how Hispanics will rule the future. And let's go now to our $500 winner, Liz Mary. Liz.
Yay! Yay!
Unbelievable.
Congratulations.
Hello, Liz.
Hi, Liz.
Hey, Liz. Lots of happiness.
Thank you. $500 worth of happiness. Woo!
Now, Liz, you listen all the time, and many people think, you know, that you may not deserve it or it was fixed or something. Did you think, did you send signals to get Ira to pull your name?
I did. I promised him half, actually.
You promised him head?
Thank you.
Half.
Oh, half. Oh, I
thought. Not head. Half.
Yeah. All right. Well, Liz, what will you do with the $500, Liz?
Well, you know what? First thing I got to do is go up and see Genius Garrett at the Hat Creek Radio Telescope Array, because I haven't been there. Now I got to go because they won me $500.
All right.
Maybe I'll bring him some beer up there.
There you go. Liz Mary, just a loyal listener. And on Facebook, I can't tell you how many times I've seen you in those jeans and that little gingham outfit. Lovely. Liz, congratulations. $500. Geraldo's on the way. Well, I've known him a long time, been on this show and almost every show I've ever done. Geraldo, of course, you know him for Geraldo at Large, weekends at 10 o'clock Eastern Time on Fox News. And his new book, The Great Progression, How Hispanics Will Lead America to a New Era of Prosperity. Geraldo, welcome to the show again. Hey, man, how are you?
Good, Jay. How's it going? I mean, we have really kind of grown up and, I won't say grown old, but we've been on an arc together here.
You know, it's 30 years?
30 years since we met?
It is, 30 years. That's ridiculous.
That is ridiculous. I started 40 years ago today. Today's my anniversary.
I don't remember. I might have started, you know, no, I really kind of got going in New York, so I'm about 30 years. Wow. Yeah. I don't like saying that, because I used to go into the store with my dad and he'd go,
my wife, before she was my wife.
Well, y'all were doing something. I'm sorry I ever kissed her. How's that sound?
Thank you.
Yeah, no.
She's not my wife
no,
anymore. So
I know she isn't, but you weren't together, or you were together, or just getting together. I wasted, you know what, on her, kissing, and dinner, everything else.
How much money, that's the key.
The only person to ever appear on the covers of both Newsweek and Playgirl, the multi-winner of America's Best Mustache, I didn't know these things about you. Of course, Geraldo, the single name, Oprah, Elvis, Cher, and Lassie. And then, you know this? You're the top five single name people.
Snooki, you forgot Snooki.
And Snooki's big.
She's huge. She may be
more on-air prize fight. You've had more on-air boxing matches than most professional middleweights.
True.
How many people did you prize fight?
Well, it's just not the boxing. It's all the street fights and the confrontations with the skinheads and getting my nose broken and all the rest of it. It's always there's always been a physical aspect to my whatever it is I do. I didn't change that when I became a television person.
Is that that hot Latin temper?
Yeah, I guess it's that. It's also being a kid with asthma and an attitude, pimples and a chip on my shoulder. I think I just kept it my whole life.
Well, you know, we were just talking about foreign movies and how a guy was saying, how is it in Europe when you see a European movie, the people look like us, regular people. But you certainly have major, you're in a great physique, you're handsome and everything else. I mean, suppose you'd been a guy that you still had pimples and you were skinny, and do you think you would have gotten as far in American television?
You know, I was discovered. I never, ever thought that I was going to be on television. It's something I never thought of. It was just so far outside the realm of what it was that I was doing. Although, at the time I was discovered, I was, the spokesman. I was a storefront lawyer with an attitude, a bad attitude, representing the Young Lords, who are the Puerto Rican equivalent of the Black Panthers. And they took over a building, and I was there, one of their spokespeople, along with a bunch of guys that's still on television. Pablo Guzman is on WCBS. Felipe Luciano is still around. Juan Gonzalez writes for the New York Daily News. And guys who really were substantive people, but who were militant activists for the Puerto Rican community. I was representing them. I got spotted by Al Primo, who was creating Eyewitness News. He wanted every major ethnic group in New York represented. He saw me available. He offered me a place in a fellowship at Columbia Journalism School for 3 months under Fred Friendly, Edward R. Murrow's producer. I said, how much does it pay? I was making about $200 a week. He said $250. I took the gig, and 40 years ago I started. My hand was on television doing an interview with the losing candidate for state attorney general.
now you're a where'd you go to law school?
Brooklyn, right here in town, right in New York.
You know, I don't think you make a big enough deal of that. I bet you a lot of people don't remember.
I know you're an attorney.
You know, that's a big deal now, because
I was a pretty good attorney, and I've kept my license current, and that's why when I looked at the evidence in Blagojevich, I said, Fitzgerald is blowing smoke. There's no case here. Michael Jackson, I knew that however you regard him as a pervert or anything else, that the case against him was clearly a frame job in 2005. Same psychologist as at the time he settled in 93. Same lawyer, same team. Clearly, they went plaintiff shopping, or the welfare cheating mother said, this is how I can take my cancer stricken son and put him close to Michael and make these allegations, get $1 million settlement and walk away. But anyway, it's my legal background that allows me to be right on most of those calls.
Now, The Great Progression, How Hispanics Will Lead America to a New Era of Prosperity.
Counterintuitive, I know.
I know. I love having you on, but I look at this and I go, there are people shaking their heads right
now.
And
I know.
I mean,
but let me explain.
I don't disagree with you. I mean, remember, I'm of Italian heritage. You are Jewish and is it Puerto Rican? Okay. I mean,
Puerto Rican citizens, by the way.
We're all great citizens, but this is, it's almost like writing a book about being a good Muslim these days.
This is a tough one. If I had made the book Crushing Immigrants or something like that, I think I'd have a better chance, or Obama's border error or something like that. But here's my main thesis. I can tell you in 30 seconds. My main thesis is Russia and Europe share one thing in common. They have an aging population and a diminishing population, and they, like the United States, have a challenge how they're going to fund their pension programs, you know, their Social Security, Medicaid, mm-hmm. Medicare, whatever the equivalent is. We have the same aging population. People are having less than two children. The baby boomers are going to be far more numerous than the generation that precedes them and have to pay for their retirement funds and all the rest of it. But what makes the United States different is we have a vibrant immigration phenomenon happening. We have all these young people coming in, and most of them legal, but also these millions who have come across in this unofficial, informal, but generations old system that we have here. And I think it's, those are the young, strong backs. For instance, you got 1,000 migrants using the same fake Social Security number. The card is fake. They're guilty of a federal felony using this ID illegally, but that doesn't change the fact that every week, out of their paycheck, money goes to the Social Security Fund because the employer takes it out and he sends it in because otherwise he's guilty of a felony. So here are these illegals who are gifting the United States this this amazing bounty that you never hear of when you see all this footage of them climbing the wall and all the rest of it.
Well, I have a number for you. What's funny, I didn't realize you were coming on, and I had just, was sitting around one night.
Oh, you don't read the notes?
No. You know what? I didn't know you were coming on this moment, but I had just looked this up because I argue with, my right-wing friends all the time. Immigrants bring in $162 billion, illegal immigrants, in federal, state, and local taxes, and they figured out, just what you're saying, that even when they're using a fake ID, the United States actually gains about $2,000 per illegal immigrant for whatever they pay out. What I don't get is, how come no Democrat ever says shit like this?
Because they're chicken. Because they see the way the Democratic candidates are all running away from President Obama. They are totally, totally self-absorbed. They are selfish, short-sighted. That's why I hate politicians. That's why I hate the Democrats. I think they're absolutely full of crap. I think they're weak, wimpy. They stand for nothing except for whatever is pragmatic for their own particular future. And I have no regard for them, and they're getting exactly what they deserve. I feel bad for Obama. I call myself an Obama Republican. I feel bad for him. I'm loyal to him because he's the commander-in-chief. I hope that his fortunes turn around, because his fortunes are our fortunes. But on this issue, even Obama has been a chicken. Let's face it. I mean, he should have dealt with immigration before he dealt with health care, which is so unpopular. No one knows what the hell it is still, and 60% want to repeal it.
Great Progression is the book, How Hispanics Will Lead America to a New Era of Prosperity. It's Geraldo's new book. Now, this is what I really think is happening. I think this is the last gasp. Maybe it'll take 100 years, but they're not going to be white people left in the United States in 100 years.
In Arizona.
No, but I mean, they're not going to be white people left. There are more intermarriages than ever before. You know, I'm from the South, so blacks and whites and Hispanics are going to intermarry. There's not as much, look at the Jewish population. They're marrying, outside of their religion like crazy. So don't you think it's a last gasp by a lot of angry white people who can see that it's not going to be their future?
I think that you're absolutely correct to put it in racial terms, because I think that race is the engine driving all of these social issues right now.
Yeah.
And that is exactly why immigration is such a hot button, and that's why Glenn Beck's rally was such a hot button. It clearly, there is, I believe that the Tea Party movement, which grew, some say, out of the Minutemen, or they some of the same personalities transferred over. I know that that's going to be a very incendiary comment, but that's the reality. And in Arizona, what's going on is a racial reality. Three-fourths of all Anglo-Arizonans support the draconian new law. Three-fourths of Hispanic Arizonans oppose the new law. That racial divide there is exactly defining what you're talking about. There is, in many ways, in Arizona, the demographic Latinos were 5-10% of the population when I went to college there. Now they're 30% of the population. It doesn't matter if a single one crosses the border anymore. That demographic genie is out of the bottle. They will be, the United States is already the second largest Hispanic nation on earth, second only to Mexico. And it's just going to be more of that, and the United States will be darker. There's no way to stop that, and you're absolutely right about that. And that's
they'll out screw us and out populate us.
Well, I think it's certainly true. I mean, if the majority population continues not to replace itself, that is inevitable. It's not now, they're not having 17 kids like my dad's family did. He was one of 17, but they are having 4 and 5, though, like I did. And I got five little half Ricans running around everywhere.
Now, my mother's from 11, but of course, the five boys worked, in the fields with my grandfather, and the five girls.
My dad's dad was the head of a sugarcane plantation. So the kids all worked, and every kid coming up was raised by the kid ahead of them, and they went to work in the fields like my dad did.
Well, and my mother's family was wealthy, and they owned the plantation. I mean, that's like a joke, but they did. But he still had a bunch of kids, and they still worked.
A couple of bucks, Jay.
He did. They did fine. The great progression, how Hispanics will lead America to a new era of prosperity. Now, the other thing is, about 13 states have the same laws that Arizona has. But the Constitution states that the government, the United States government, is the only group that can regulate immigration. So when they scream about the Constitution, a lot of these Tea Partiers are right wing people. It's like Satan can cite scripture for his own purposes. Correct?
Well, I agree with that, and these laws will any clear minded federal judge will enjoin any of these state laws for exactly the reason you cite. It's the Supremacy Clause of the United States Constitution. However, in the composition of the Supreme Court right now, with the 5-4 ironclad conservative majority, I'm not so sure that Antonin Scalia, who is a brilliant man, can't find a way. If you could do Bush v. Gore and ruled that you can't have a full recount in Florida, which was clearly unprecedented and extraordinary, had nothing to do with any decision the court had ever made before, it is possible that this court, as presently constituted, could find the Arizona law constitutional. I think it has a reasonable shot, given the reality of the court today. So, who knows what's going to happen. I think that what you said about demographics and the nation, being a blacker and browner nation inevitably, I think that's the way to cure the problem. I'm not at all confident that the federal courts will do what I think the Constitution says they should do.
Well, it's just going to happen. It's just time is going to pass, and
it's going to happen hopefully in our lifetime.
Will you go on the Glenn Beck show with this book, The Great Progression?
I haven't been invited on Glenn's show, and he doesn't come on mine. O'Reilly gave it a big mention, though, and O'Reilly and I had the famous confrontation over, the issue in 2007 when people thought we were going to jump on each other. It was so heated. Download it on Google. I mean, it's got millions of hits. It was so close to it was as close as I ever came to a fist fight, and I didn't throw a punch.
But you know what? O'Reilly doesn't seem as combative now as he did.
He really is. I mean, Beck has a whole other trip going on, and I don't fault him at all, and there's no other man in the country could have delivered 500,000 people on a hot August Saturday in D.C. but him. And he's got he did something that was extraordinary, and I believe that he is, in many ways, the main root of the tree that's come to be known as the Tea Party. I'm mixing metaphors there.
So let's say that every black person in the United States dresses like the average white guy would like them to dress. Every Hispanic speaks as good English as they can speak and wears a as nice outfit as they can wear, and you don't hear Mexican music or hip-hop or rap or whatever, do you think that the average American or the average Fox viewer, and I'm sure there are a lot of black conservatives and Hispanic conservatives, but do you think the average American would find that palatable?
Probably. I think race is a deep-seated emotion, and everybody's motivated, by whatever their genetic memory is.
Geraldo, you speak the king's English. You're a lawyer. I speak the king. We're both very ethnic guys.
For instance, it's all about social and economic status. It's not about color. If you've got, Vernon Jordan at your party, I mean, he's a big deal. He's a big mover and shaker, and people, I don't think, look at him and say, look at that black guy. Look at him and say, look at that big man with all that fat wallet. New York is one thing. I'm not sure about how things are. And although I've traveled so extensively that I feel at home everywhere, I'm not sure that a rich, swinging black guy in old Mississippi would get the same kind of regard as a rich, swinging white guy. But maybe. I think that it's mostly, I don't know. But I think that if you're hip and modern and happening, P. Diddy's going to get about anywhere he wants to go.
Now, in your book, The Great Progression, you mention, Acorn, which was completely vilified by those kids that went in. And
wrongfully, and unconstitutionally, I believe.
I understand that. And one of them may go to jail because of Louisiana. Did you write that before Acorn got in all their trouble?
Yeah, I wrote that before that. I mean, the book was written essentially last year. Today's the first day of the publication of the paperback. And I did a new front on it, pegged to a question that I asked the reader. And the question is a very difficult question. We sent an equal number of National Guardsmen to the BP oil spill at its worst, after considerable agonizing over to Louisiana, that we sent to the Arizona border to shore up the porous border defenses. And my question was, because they delayed so long, which was more important, to send those troops to the shoreline of Louisiana, we had oil ruining the precious marshes, or send them to stand with their penises in their hand on the Sonora-Arizona border, where they're side-by-side with Border Patrol officers far better equipped to do the job than they are, and with a number of troops that, if they're going to truly seal that border, was pathetically undermanned, as McCain said, and George Bush had five times that many U.S. soldiers assigned to the border when he was president, and responding to a similar hysterical, spike in the anti-immigrant sentiment. It's a purely political act to send troops to the border. They don't add anything to the security of the border. Ask any Border Patrolman. And to be conflicted about which was more important, troops to the oil spill where they really could have done something, or troops to the desert where it was purely a political act, I ask folks that, and their reaction has been, so far we'll see what their reaction is. But I suspect the emotional issue of immigration is so raw that even the practical reality of having to stop something like an oil spill from wrecking a wetland would be subverted or subjugated or subordinated, is the best word, to something that's purely a gesture, a gesture of militancy against immigration. It's so irrational now that it's out of control, and I'm not sure Obama has the spit anymore to bring it, to rein it in.
Do you think he would ever say anything close to that? Do you think he'd ever speak because he wants to be elected to another, term, and he wants to save Democrats?
Latinos aren't going to turn out. Remember, I call him in the book the first Latino president. And I do that because if it wasn't for the Latino vote, he would not have won in Nevada, New Mexico, Virginia, North Carolina, Florida, I argue. If you take out the Latino vote, which was overwhelming for Obama, unlike the vote for George W. Bush, Bush got almost half of the Latino vote. Obama got two-thirds of the Latino vote. And so McCain got one-third of the Latino vote. And if Obama doesn't get that kind of spike again, and the young people get lazy, and black people go back to historic voter turnout, and, now the enthusiasm over Obama's waned, I think he is a one-term president, and I think that's too bad. I really... I love the guy, and I love his family, and I love what he stands for. And, you know, he made some bad legislative choices, but I still think he's not a failed president. He could bail it out yet.
The great progression, how Hispanics will lead America to a new era of prosperity. Do you think any Anglos are going to buy your book, Geraldo?
No, I don't. I have no hope other than maybe libraries.
Why don't you run for office? Now, here's another one. Would you not run for office?
Record, and yeah. If people want to read the other side of the story, and I doubt many do, but if people do, then I know this is counter-commercial, but I just think that people have to wake up to the fact that they're being duped, that the violence in Mexico has not spilled over the border. You know, the kidnappings that are going on in Phoenix are all intramural among these Mexican drug gangs. They haven't struck out at anybody outside that community. You know, I think you got to regularize the flow of these people over the border. You got to give them the good people, the hardworking people, 99%, I argue, of the people who come across. And I just don't think that argument has much resonance now. People are so angry, though, Jay.
Yeah. Well, Geraldo, thanks. The great progression,
anytime,
how
man.
Hispanics will lead America to a new era of prosperity. You've been around so long that you've decided, fuck it, I'm going to write what I feel like writing.
I care about it.
Okay, good.
Book, and if you don't like it, then maybe your kids will like it in the library someday.
Well, we're on Sirius, so I can say it. If you don't like it, go fuck yourself.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah.
Thanks, man.
Hey, Geraldo, thanks very much.
Anytime, Jay.
Okay, buddy. Thank you. There you go. You know what, Garrett, have you been with me when Geraldo came in before? Or
I've been for maybe two other ones at the most.
Do you not think this is the most relaxed he's been?
It definitely was, yeah.
Most kind of like, you know, he would always kind of calm me down a little bit if I said something to him or joked to him. Right. You know, it is. It's that, fuck it. You know, he wrote this.
It is what it's like, yeah. It's just like he's done with.
Yeah.
Caring.
And when you're done with caring, the Jay Thomas Show is where you belong. That's it. That's the most relaxed I've ever been with him. Not because we agree or disagree, but the reality is I don't know what I think of the Hispanics in the future. That's true. And remember, there are going to be more black children, more Hispanic children. When you say Hispanic, by the way, you're talking about all of South America and Central America, okay? And the Canadians, they aren't going to outscrew anybody, you know? But, you know, if their population continued to grow at some alarming rate, you would see Canadians pouring over the border. Apparently now all you see is actors and goddamn comedians coming in, stealing our jobs. But, so I believe, and this is, listen, I have no interest in seeing women walk down the street with only their eyes showing and the headdress. I find that personally offensive. But I know they have every right in the world to worship like that. I also have no interest in these evangelists on television. But I know they have every right to say whatever they want to say on TV. When I see the Cinco de Mayo parade every year and I see all the little tiny babies of the parents, by the way, you know, the men and women, the Hispanic families have much more of a central unified family, whether they're married legally or not. But I go, you don't have enough fucking money to feed yourselves. Why are you having all these fucking kids? When I see all of that, I don't like any of it. I don't like one. So I'm one of these older white guys who is seeing the end. And I'm half, you know, Sicilian, is half Sicilian. And my dad was a true Anglo-Saxon and part Native American and everything else. That's really what it is. It is the end of being an Anglo-Saxon in the United States. And it is very painful. It is real. I mean, do you really, Garrett, imagine, give yourself 20 more years, when people look back at music, they're going to be waxing poetically about T.I. and about fucking rap. I mean, think about it. And about rap and everything else. You're not going to be able to identify with that at all on any level. You're going to one day be one of those angry white guys. Because you're really white.
How am I really white?
Garrett's? What are you kidding? You probably have some relatives that have goddamn fucking who knows what kind of uniforms on.
Definitely not.
Huh?
Definitely not.
White.
Whatever. Who cares?
One day you're gonna be in your.
You're
white.
You're white.
You grew up with segregation and everything, and it's on your mind. People like me and younger, no one cares anymore.
The only people who have best friends that are black or Hispanic are on sitcoms.
That is correct.
Thank you. And in beer commercials.
Well, Christina, has a black roommate.
True.
Now, I watched Boise State against Virginia Tech last night. You know, I love football. And I wanted Boise State to lose.
Why?
Badly. Well, I'll tell you why.
You always like the underdog.
Well, here's why. I am not nuts about BYU, Utah State, Boise State, and all
TCU.
That. TCU? No, TCU doesn't drive me too crazy, but I look at these schools and I go, these are Mormon institutions. These are white Mormon states. The schools have 80% white players on them, you know, and that's why they got their asses beat forever. And then the Mormons one day said, oh, by the way, blacks and women can have a place in the afterlife, because they needed, you know, their basketball team and their football team to win. I truly believe that. From the bottom of my heart, I believe the prophet got sick of BYU getting beaten in bowl games. And the next thing you know, they allowed blacks to have a place on earth. They used to not allow you to have a place on earth, right? It was, you got in the afterlife, women and blacks. So I watched this thing last night and I go, Virginia Tech is going to beat them by 15 touchdowns, right? I look at Virginia Tech, and we know who comes to Virginia Tech.
Michael Vick.
And his brother.
Yeah.
Fucking criminals. Both of them. Evil, dog-fighting, no-good criminals, in my estimation. Scumbags. Certainly not scholar athletes. I look at the rest of this Virginia Tech team, and I listen to the Lily White coach talk and his wife and the whole thing. I'm thinking, wait a second. This guy had to know all that shit was going on, right? Then you look over at Boise State, and these are the biggest, fastest, meanest white kids you've ever seen. And they have about, you know, 10% black kids in the team, and they're all very good. And you look at Boise State, they have a really high graduation rate. They really are mom and apple pie and the whole deal. And after a few minutes, I'm going, there's no way they can win the game. But all of a sudden, they played out of their fucking minds, and they ended up winning this game against a team that I think was better, right? Mm-hmm. And I looked at that and I thought, well, shit, you know, why don't I like that team? Why don't I go for that? Because those people, and when I say those people, I mean those white people, they speak much more to what I believe in and to what music I listen to than the Michael Vicks of the world. So I started cheering for Boise State at the end of the game. My wife from the other room goes, thought you hated Mormons. I go, normally I do.
I didn't know you they know. Were Mormon.
Oh, God.
They're from Idaho, not Utah.
Oh, please. What color is a potato when you open up the outside of it?
White.
You betcha. Potato pancakes?
White.
Everything. Even when you go to Spokane.
French fries are kind of golden, though.
That's a Mormon with a tan. When you go to Spokane, Washington,
mm-hmm.
Mormons. I once did a voiceover. I was on vacation somewhere. And I don't know where we were, in Washington State, whatever. And I have to drive to, like, Spokane to, like, do this commercial, right? I don't know what. Oh, I was in. I don't know where I was, but I had to drive, like, 30 minutes to find a studio. And when I went to the studio, this guy says to me, you know, I know a little bit about your reputation. You know, be careful what you say here in the office. There are a lot of Mormons here. This guy said to me, I said, what does that mean? He goes, well, you know, you may joke around and stuff. And I said, okay. And when I went in there, there were all these blue-eyed, you know, they're like Glenn Beck, who became a Mormon, right? If you were a Mormon, you'd throw Glenn Beck, you know, I mean, you ought to be like, you ought to live in Salt Lake, is what you're thinking. But no, it has spread all over the country. So yeah, I think, and Geraldo agreed with me, I think it is the last gasp of the all that founding father shit they keep saying. What do you think they're saying? They're saying white guys.
Well, that's the problem, too.
That's what they're saying.
I mean, even
founding fathers. Fuck the founding fathers. They were slaveholders, for Christ's sakes.
Exactly.
Are you kidding?
I think even white people are tired of the white people created this country thing.
And you know what? Thomas Jefferson, you don't have any pictures of him shooting a gun. You don't have any pictures of George Washington shooting a gun. You don't have any pictures of any of them shooting guns. Guns were so, and people always go, oh, no, I remember I live with a gun historian, a kid that's becoming an expert and historian in the making and the knowledge of guns. The gun wouldn't go 5 feet. So that's all fucking bullshit. And we had just finished, you know, throwing out a king. And so they said, well, if we ever have to do this again, do you know that crazy woman that's running against Harry Reid in Nevada said that maybe if things don't turn around, we need to use our Second Amendment rights and throw them out by armed conflict?
Fucking Congress?
Yeah, whatever. Yeah, just fucking idiot.
I think Congress has bigger guns than the people.
Absolutely. Goddamn, they got the army.
Yeah.
Then you got Ron Paul's son, who said that he thinks there should be racial discrimination in the workplace, and he thinks that that you should be able to use race at a private club. Guess what? So do I. Except that's wrong. Of course I do. I'd love to walk into a club and everybody is 5'8" with dark curly hair and a big mouth. I would.
You'd hate that.
I wouldn't.
You wouldn't stick out.
Well, wait a minute now. But I'd love to walk into a club with members that I had handpicked.
Yes.
That adore me or that whatever it is.
Okay.
And I would only pick white guys. I said, hi. How you doing there, man? How are you? Sorry. Oh, I'd only pick black guys. I said, how are you, Reginald Johnson? I'd only pick Hispanic guys. Biff Salazar, how are you? That's what I would do. They would all be the same. Isn't that true of every? Christina, would you really want to live with the people you watch religiously on reality shows?
Oh, God.
Are you sure?
The Housewives of New Jersey.
Of course.
Would you
I
like
do.
To. That woman, Teresa,
of
who's.
Of course.
You would want to be in their houses with them.
Yes.
Then you are. Well, okay. Then you're. I mean, they're low rent. I don't care how much
fine.
Money they
have. It's entertainment. I don't have to watch it on TV.
You just want to sit
life.
There and look at them?
Yes. Like a fly on the wall.
Would you marry the situation?
No. God.
I would.
Would you sleep with him?
No.
What? Oh. Just to have him grind on you
ew.
With those abs?
Ew. No.
Just
definitely
for the story?
Not. No story is good enough for that. I don't care what it is.
Let's go to Don of Delaware. Hello, Don. It's Jay Thomas. How are you? We just had Geraldo on promoting a book he knows that nothing but Hispanics will read. The most honest little interview. That was so much fun for me. Yes, go ahead, Don. How are you?
Well, hey, pretty good. I called you directly after the Kevin Bacon interview, and the last time I think I spoke to you was then, and I just wanted to say I'm glad you didn't fuck this one up. You did.
You know what? Can we go back to the Kevin Bacon? And can I be honest and not act silly for 1 minute? Can I be honest with you? If you are in a situation and some monumental thing that has affected the entire nation, I'll tell you how bad the Bernie Madoff thing is. My accountant forever has been able to. His signature and mine or whatever, I gave him power of attorney, whatever. Do you know you can't do that anymore because of Bernie Madoff? All of this bullshit mail comes to my house now. All of this shit because of Bernie Madoff. Bernie Madoff is the greatest thief and one of the largest destroyers of the personal financial institutions in the United States. Kevin Bacon was a part of that. He is a public figure. He is on a public radio show. I asked him a normal fucking question about it. And what makes me mad about him is if Geraldo had lost his money with that asshole, or if I'd lost mine, we'd have talked about it. That fuck that guy. Fuck Kevin. Fucking, what's his name, Bacon? Fuck him. And I mean it.
If you can't,
why would you come on a radio show? Fuck him. And you know what? If I had a friend and he couldn't talk about it, fuck him too. You mean, like my wife will have people over. She goes, don't ask Joan about Jeff. They were married for 30 fucking years, okay? So they broke up. I can't say, hey, Joan, talk to Jeff. No, you cannot. Cannot. That's crazy. It's fucking nuts.
Go ahead, Jay.
I'm done.
Hey, I want to tell you something, too.
So don't tell me I fucked it up. I didn't fuck it up. I was being honest with Kevin fucking Bacon.
You did a good job. You did a good job.
No, but I asked Geraldo everything I wanted to ask him, and he answered honestly. Indicon. Same thing with myriads of other guests that we have. Well, same goes for goddamn Caroline fucking Kennedy. Fuck her.
How did that one go?
Not good.
I don't know. Didn't go good?
A long time ago. What other one didn't go well, Gary? The Ballston Spa Bottle Museum lady.
She didn't like you before you called, though.
Thank you!
I think that's like some type of preconceived notions about you or something, because she was a bitch from the gate. You know what I mean? So I wouldn't lose sleep over that.
You know who I loved? I loved Geraldo today, and I loved the woman from the Adventure Suites. Perfect. This has been no. The woman that had the Holiday Road a couple hours ago, the woman that had the Adventure Suites. Tell you what, Don, this is a perfect day. Don't ruin it for me. All right.
I'm saying you did good. Normally, I'm a smartass to you. I'm being nice.
I don't trust you.
I was going to go into the whole racial thing and move on, but you wanted to.
I don't trust. You know what, Don? And by the way, you're one of the black people that acts white that I can deal with. That's right. You act white. I can deal with you.
Let me tell you something. It's backfiring on me completely. It ain't working anymore.
Now, what do you think of white guys like me who act black every now and again, slap five, and pretend we're from the street?
I don't know. That's just such an anomaly. It doesn't, I mean, you can't.
I
really
do that shit all the time. Oh, I get what you're saying. I'm from the street myself. Yeah. I know your pain.
No, you don't.
Slap five. High five. I can't keep up with it. What is it this week? The two fists together? I can't keep up with it.
I just stick with the fist bump. It stays, you know, because I
personally
can't keep up with it anyway.
I'm going to go to break after this, but I want to start a new one. The ass bump.
When
you see somebody you like, you both turn around and you bump your asses into each
other. That's faggotry, Jay.
No, it isn't. I'm going to start. Garrett, when I come to New York, I'm only ass bumping people. Mm. My new thing.
Nice.
How about this? You fist them in the ass. No. I don't mean put it in their ass, but you just put your fist.
Well, Jay, I wanted to say you did a good job.
You put your ass out, Garrett, and you just put your fist on their ass a little bit. Thank you, Don. All right, stay where you are. This show's long for me. Oh, Christina, we got to tell everybody what Garrett did, right?
Yeah. Should we tell him or should he tell him?
No, he'll tell. He'll tell.
He's a sick
As
bastard.
My mother would say, oh, you see, they're not so nice. She would say that. I'd say, oh, I saw him. Garrett's a great guy. Oh, God, I could just tell you things. He's not so nice.
Mm-hmm.
So, Garrett, tell us we're all talking about our weekends, you know, and we're waiting for the spots to end, you know, and everything else, and this and that and the other. And Christine and I are talking, and then you go, guess what I did this weekend? And we both, and Christina, what did you guess? What was your guess?
I assumed that he went ring shopping.
Ring shopping, that's right.
Because he lives with his girlfriend now.
I said, don't do that. And then I said, oh, he's going to confess something like rehab. He's going to say something tender and gentle, like he never does. And we were, our mouths were open. I mean, they were agape, actually. We were in anticipation of what you were going to say. So go ahead, Garrett. Share it with people.
Well, Friday night, I had some hot, spicy Indian food. Mm-hmm.
And I woke up Saturday morning and deposited that Indian food in my bathroom.
Why do you use the word deposited?
And what did, so what did you say, Christina? What did you say when he said that?
I said, gross. Why do you have to say the word deposit?
No, no. You said, I didn't think it was going to go in this direction.
Oh, yeah, I didn't think it was this is a turn for the worse.
It was a turn for the worse, right? I said, yes, I couldn't imagine. So you deposited the Indian food, yes?
Yeah, it was just like a shapeless pile.
All right. We don't need all that.
So I noticed how the smell was just amazing to me. So I run into my bedroom and tell my girlfriend, for some reason, it smells like cinnamon rolls in the bathroom. And she gets out of bed, runs to the bathroom, and she just starts
gagging. You are such an asshole. She has every right to move out of that apartment without paying you a dime from here on out, as far as I'm concerned.
Why? Oh
my because you're gosh. Disgusting.
That was a That's playful joke.
There's nothing playful about that. It's between, Indian food.
Wait a minute. A playful joke between... And you stop. Between what?
Yes. Between two lovers.
Ooh. Oh! Jay!
Wow.
I can't believe this.
Between two lovers.
He's going ring shopping. I'm telling you. It's happening right here in the Diamond District. Can
You'll
I come with you?
Get married to your non-boyfriend.
Can I come with you when you go look?
No.
I'll bring the flip cam.
Can you get Andrea on the phone, please?
Sure. Yeah.
Get Andrea on the phone. Andrea Bushy. Now, Art Sears is the main guy, but for some reason doesn't like to be on the radio. Don't know why. He'd rather, I don't know what, play with his three kids or worry about his mortgage or book people or whatever. But Andrea, his niece, has been our main guest producer for 2 or 3 years now. Does a terrific job. But we get into these little emailings back and forth about various people, and I like you to hear the inner workings of a radio show because we really do have a plan. I mean, sometimes the plan goes awry, but we actually do decide what we're going to talk about and have discussions and little production meetings and put little things together. So, I mean, this is the fourth email I've received from her concerning a possible guest. And is she there?
She's not. Oh. Hey, Andrea. It's Garrett. Jay wants to talk to you.
Yeah, put her on the air.
About some email.
Poor Andrea.
Just hold on.
No, no, she's great. She's wonderful. Mm-hmm. She's wonderful. Andrea, congratulations. The holiday roads were spectacular.
Oh, good. I'm glad.
I read a book once called The 1 Minute Manager. It said always compliment a person before you tell them the real reason. Here's the other one. The third thing a person says to you when they call is what they really called about. Did you know that?
No, but I can imagine.
Oh, yeah. How are the kids? Kids good? Baby's good?
Yeah, they're actually banging them down the door. I'm in the bedroom.
They're banging down the door. Well, yeah. That's my favorite thing to talk about. When you get married, you have to learn how to have an orgasm with... Mommy and Daddy, what are you doing? What are you doing in there? What? Well, here's the one I like. Where is the door lock? Mommy! Oh, yeah. You need to learn how to have an orgasm like that. Now, here's the third thing. I asked you to get on the air the National Horseshoe Pitch Champion, right?
Yes.
So, usually okay, and then the next thing you know, the person is booked. Alan Francis is his name.
Yeah.
So this is the third email I've received. What would you read? Do you have the emails in front of you?
No.
I'll read them. You got the kids beating on the door? Let them in. Let the kids in. I tell you what, let me get on the phone with one of them, and that'll be the end of the yelling. Okay?
I don't want to traumatize them, Jay.
Hello. You had better be good. I'll visit you tonight in your room. Oh, yeah. I'll fix their asses. Good. Now, you sent off the request to the National Horseshoe Pitchers Association.
Yes.
And they wrote back. Hi, Andrea. thank you for your interest in the National Horseshoe Pitchers Association and our world champion pitcher, Alan Francis. Can you give me any more details on the type of interview Jay would be doing with Alan?
Mm-hmm.
And you sent me an email that said, Jay, what do you want to talk to the horseshoe champion about? I emailed you back, horseshoe pitching.
Yeah.
You said, well, Jay, that's obvious. Anything else? They are skeptical. Andrea, if I sat for an hour at my desk, I couldn't think of anything scandalous to say to the horseshoe pitcher, okay?
Well, sometimes I feel unethical booking a guest when I know that you're going to maybe be
what?
A little
what?
Hard on them, and but they're expecting like a rosy interview. So I thought maybe you'd make fun of the horseshoe pitcher.
You know what, Andrea, and I mean this.
What?
I'm not hard on people. I'm honest, and I'm asking questions of a person of interest. Now, it's, here's another email. Andrea, we like to see our association and its athletes treated with respect and presented in a positive light. Alan works all day, and I would need to confirm that he would be available at 5 p.m. tomorrow. This comes from Tina Hawkins, second vice president. Can you imagine? They've got more than one vice president at the National Horseshoe Pitchers Association. Now, Garrett, what possible unfortunate question could we even think of for the horseshoe pitch champion? I can't even think
you
of one.
You would maybe ask if all pitchers were gay or something like that?
No!
Yeah, are you a pitcher or a catcher?
No, that's so...
I heard
you like to throw shoes on your rod or something, you know, the rod
you know
would
what?
Come in.
You know something? That's for some, like stupid person would do that. That's not even inventive. I would say something like, if a woman bent over naked and she straddled, and I'd say this, hey, by the way, what do you call the thing that the horseshoe goes around? What is that, Andrea?
A stake?
I don't know. I'm not the National Horseshoe Pitch Champion. But the horseshoe pitch champion would say it's the... whatever. So
it'd probably be called like the scroter, and then you'd be like the scrotum, and then the whole interview would be about the scrotum.
Look,
we have to play too.
All right, you know what, Andrea, just book the horseshoe pitching guy, tell him that I was the junior champion when I was in New Orleans, and I want to discuss it with him. Okay,
that's what I'll say.
And here's what I'm going to say to you right now, Andrea. Just get it done.
All right, but, you know...
I don't want to hear anymore. You just get it done or get out.
All right, that's fine. I'll have to live with myself for lying, but that's fine.
You're not lying. I was the champion.
Okay.
At a barbecue once. All right. And I don't need the laughter in the middle of a meeting. All right, we'll be right back. Oh, now, Andrea, what sort of art was it that guy, we asked you this 2 hours ago.
Who's Andrea?
Christina.
Yes.
What kind of art was it?
It was impressionist art.
Of what? What was it a picture of?
You know, of people or a cottage off in the distance.
An impression of what it would look like through a teardrop.
Yes.
All right.
The flicker of your eye.
We've answered every question, and we still have a lot more to talk about. But Garrett, Mr. Cinnamon Ass, Cinnamon Bun Ass.
That's a good one.
We'll do it tomorrow. All right. See you later.